Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mr. B, George Balanchine's 20th Century, by Jennifer Homans, read by Cassandra Campbell. Why we use words. You know why? To communicate with somebody else, you see. The real life, the real reality, it's not on Earth. It's what we cannot explain with words. You would never abandon things on Earth, so that's why you don't get anywhere. The portals are open for you, but the passage is narrow. I believe in the moment. I believe in that moment. I believe what I see. The importance of the dance is the person. Choreographer doesn't exist. He suggests. Ballet belongs to a dancer that is now at this moment in front of you. George Balanchine. Introduction. Dead Souls. This, the suffering, the grit and hardship of everyday life, never once appeared in Balanchine's dances. It did not interest him. It was pedestrian, a degradation of the human body and spirit. Even the dead bodies in his ballets were set against a backdrop of eternity and had a sense of spirituality and redemption that elevated the body out of the ordinary. Dead bodies, yes, but really dead souls. These were bodies purified and transfigured by the disciplined practices of ballet. And if loss was a theme in his dances, so were love and full-fleshed joy. He made many gorgeously costumed ballets that built to a crescendo with colorful kaleidoscope patterns of dancers synchronizing ever more complicated and demanding rhythms. These were fantastic entertainments that lifted audiences into the great good humor of being alive. He saw himself as a musician and theater man, traveling ballet master, and he had worked in great opera houses and touring troupes. From the Russian Tsar's Mariinsky Theater of his training and youth to the Paris Opera, Broadway, Hollywood, and his own New York City Ballet, NYCB, which he co-founded in 1948. He said he was a showman, and like the old Commedia dell'arte performers, he reinvented himself many times. He seemed ageless. For his dancers, even at the end of his life, Mr. B was a god, and they surrendered their own young lives for a chance to dance his glorious ballets. There was some part of him that did not think of himself as mortal at all. I am not a male. I am water and air, and I am servant. Or, I am a cloud in trousers, he said, a phrase borrowed from a poem he had learned early in life by the Russian poet Vladimir Mayakovsky. Some of the dancers who knew him best secretly called him the breath, another word for spirit, really. What this suggested, and it was a central theme of his life, was that he felt like a man with two bodies, and he lived in them both simultaneously, with, at times, heartbreaking personal consequences. The first was the trousers. The earthly man delighted by sensual feelings and desires, who loved good food, fine wine, beautiful women. He devoted his life to dancing, and everyone said that in rehearsals, even in his old age, he was more physically animated, expressive, and alive than any of his astonishingly athletic and youthful performers. The cloud or breath was something else. And he saw it as the source of his gift. It wasn't mind, exactly. It was more a physical inwardness, and at moments he could appear strangely detached, almost androgynous or asexual, like an angel who knows everything but feels nothing, a servant bearing dances to the gods, an airy floating spirit, elusive at times even to himself. He lived through his dancers. He was not like Mozart or Einstein or Picasso, working alone to change the way people hear or think or see. He needed dancers in a whole theatrical enterprise, but dancers above all. His gift didn't exist without them, and the most disoriented moments of his life were those when he found himself alone and unattached to dancers. He had to have them, and he gathered them and shaped them, making his own paints and pigments from their flesh and blood, meticulously reading and sculpting their minds and bodies. Making dances was personal, psychological, intimate even. They liked to say he knew them better than they knew themselves. And because women were his primary material, and because he was a man who loved women, sensuality and love were always a part of it. For a genius, Balanchine felt small. Maloros, he called himself because he felt undersized. And as a child in Russia, they had called him the rat for his persistent facial tic, a kind of nervous sniffing and twitching under the right eye as he spoke, almost like a visual stutter. He sketched himself in childlike drawings at the end of letters he wrote to lovers as a tiny mouse in the company of a large female cat that he fed and nurtured. In his mind's eye, he was that man mouse, mighty mouse, a flourish at the bottom of the page. And he didn't imagine himself as particularly attractive, though women found him sexy. The mouse was like the cloud or the breath, something a bit secret in their midst, a watcher scurrying around in his mind, preparing great delicacies for his dancers and audiences to enjoy. In reality, he was not small at all, but physically quite average. Average height, average weight, average proportions. He had fine dark features. "I am Georgian," he liked to say. And his Caucasian roots were visible in his dark, almond-shaped eyes, pensive and inward in portraits, but lit and expressive in life. His forehead was high, and he had a delicate but large, straight-edged nose, bigger is better, that became his signature feature in the sketches of his face in profile that he used to sign letters. Only his hands were fleshy and muscular, perhaps from playing the piano, which he did almost daily for most of his life. He liked to work with his hands, cooking, but also carpentry and gardening. He could be found at the local market, carefully touching and testing for firm cucumbers or the perfect tomato. Smells mattered, and once he could afford it, perfumes were a routine purchase for the women dancers he admired, a different scent for each. Appearances mattered too, and he had a dandy's interest in clothing and dress. Pictures from his St. Petersburg youth show him with a dramatic flair, hair slicked back in a Byron-esque sweep, with dark eye makeup to emphasize the point. Later, in Europe, he favored Italian suits and bow ties or colorful foulards, and he loved his American Western-style shirts with string ties and a turquoise flourish. In the studio, it was a simple shirt, neat slacks, and flexible jazz or street shoes, and everyone remembers how he would roll up his sleeves as he entered the room, a sign that the work was about to begin. He took a personal interest in costume design and could be seen bent lovingly over a swath of fabric or absorbed in adjusting a headdress, and he always insisted on the finest materials for his dancers. These sensual delights came against a backdrop of hardship and privation. He had experienced cold and starvation as a child in revolutionary Russia, his skin covered with pus-filled boils from malnutrition. The fear of gnawing hunger and the acrid smell of dead bodies piled in the streets in those early years never really left him. He had a weakened constitution. He was struck with tuberculosis, TB, as a young man, and soon after his arrival in the United States in 1933, he suffered mysterious epileptic-like fits and recurrences of TB, leaving him with a collapsed lung and narrowing left chest. Hardly a year passed when he was not suffering or seeking medical help for some real or imagined ailment. Another source, perhaps, of his feeling small and vulnerable, but also part of his enormous stamina and determination to enjoy life's pleasures and, above all, to make his dancers perform to their very fullest. "What's the matter with now?" he would say. "You might be dead tomorrow." But really, it was all something of a secret. How Balanchine made his extraordinary dances, and how the New York City Ballet had come to be, nobody quite knew, and nobody could quite say. In the early 1960s, Balanchine wrote an unusually terse letter to his associate, Betty Cage, asking her to please turn down a request to write his biography by a journalist he didn't particularly like. "If he wants to know about my inspiration or who is my muse," Balanchine wrote, "then he will never know that, because I won't tell him, and it is not going to be written anywhere for anybody to know." There was something urgent in the secrecy, and Balanchine built walls around his gift and walls around his company, as if there was some kind of magic spell that might be broken by exposure. By the time he died, the company was not just a company. It was a kind of secret society, a utopian community with its own elaborate rituals and taboos. And they were all members, monks and angels, mute scribes and devotees of Balanchine's art. Family secrets were never divulged. Not because they were ugly or incriminating, though some were, but because the secret was part of the power. It was part of what they were all doing there together. "If they knew," he once said, "they would think I was crazy." Other than the dancers, Lincoln Kirstein, brilliant, huge, troubled, mad, loyal Lincoln, was the only one who understood, and they didn't talk about it either. Americans like to see Balanchine in their own 20th century light. Wasn't he making ballet modern, abstract, 12-tone, and progressive? And weren't his dances icons of speed and urban accomplishment, ornaments to freedom and innovation? The State Department sent the company out on Cold War tours, and Balanchine went, "I am an American," but the sight of communism sickened him more than they could imagine. Russia was probably the deepest disappointment he had ever known. He had seen and suffered the way communism could turn words and reason to wood, and he had set his own path away from the materialist Bolshevik revolution that had violently interrupted his childhood and seduced his native land. And so there he was in New York City, quietly building a village of angels and erecting a music-filled monument to faith and unreason, to body and beauty. It was his own counter-revolutionary world of the spirit, an alternate vision of the 20th century. Balanchine himself was a kind of secret, too. Restraint and civility were his natural disposition, and he was a deeply private man. The mask came naturally, at birth, perhaps, but was fixed over years of history and experience. As he built the NYCB up around himself, he withdrew more and more inside. No drama, no tempers, no pretense, a simple craftsman at work daily. Even his use of language was secretive. He was a sophisticated linguist and spoke Russian, German, French, and English. He loved wordplay and puns and wrote limericks, many of them erotic, and romantic song lyrics. Yet although he lived in the United States for 50 years, he spoke a strange pidgin English that was extremely expressive, but impossible to pin down in its winding syntax. It was brilliant but eccentric, hidden, foreign, part of the mask, and also a way of still being Russian, not Soviet, but his own Russia, of his own making. He wasn't an intellectual, W.H. Auden had rightly observed, but something more, a man who understands everything. I have been alive for a long time, Balanchine would later say. And he did know a lot, read a lot, but he held all of that to himself and dispensed it patiently in thin streams to reporters or dancers or curious outsiders who blankly ignored his digressions into the finer points of fairies or the afterlife. He conserved energy, temper, ideas, concentrated them in an increasingly dense and inner world that had fewer and fewer outlets as he aged. By the end, the only real problem he faced was the one he and his dancers had made together. How to live in the real world when the unreal world of the stage was so much more alive. He didn't think about it much. He focused on music, the grounding and floor of his life and dances. He read books, he played the piano, he absorbed, he cooked, he gardened, he liked carpentry. He ironed his own shirts and could be seen through the window of his apartment in the early morning hours with a towel around his waist, ironing alone. He washed cars and he made ballets. The rest was left unspoken. It is all in the dances, he said. But it wasn't, quite. Russia. Chapter 1. Happy Families. When Georgi was born one cold January day in 1904, he was his mother's first illegitimate son. It was official. He was number 160 on the list of newborns at the Church of the Nativity on the Sands in St. Petersburg, where Maria Nikolaevna Vasilieva had dutifully registered his arrival. On this critical document establishing Balanchine's existence in the eyes of God and the Russian state, his father was absent, and his mother, the authorities noted in a neat hand, was Orthodox but unwed. The problem was not only that Balanchine came into the world in a half-fallen bastard state, somehow discredited from the start. It was also that without a father, Georgi had no patronymic, and without a patronymic, his entire genealogy was in doubt. Who was he, even? His older sister, Tamara, born 2 years earlier, was illegitimate, too. Ditto his brother, Andrei, who came a year after Georgi in 1905. On Tamara's document, illegitimate was even scrawled like a scarlet letter in bold capitals under her name. Had Maria's children been born in Western Europe, they might have held some rights through their mother. But this was Russia, and the children automatically took the legal status of their father. The sad fact was that without a paterfamilias, none of them had any legal standing at all. They hardly existed. There was only one way back into the social and political fold. In special cases, usually with influence and money changing hands, a child might be legitimized ex post facto by imperial consent and the word of the czar himself. A cramped note in new ink amending Tamara, Georgi's, and Andrei's birth documents tells us that this is exactly what happened. On March 18, 1906, the district court legitimized the birth of each of Maria's three children. And on September 23rd, the church recognized this change in status too. It was all verified for anyone who cared to look in document number 13025. When Georgi was later asked for his birth certificate, he was able to present an official dictum, birth certificate number 5055, grandly stating that by imperial decree at the St. Petersburg County Court of the 7th District and acting on a decision from March 18, 1906, it was hereby affirmed that Georgi Melitonovich Balanchivadze had in fact been born to legally wedded parents, both of the Orthodox Christian faith, and both married for the first time. His father, it was proclaimed, was the hereditary honorable citizen Meliton Antonovich Balanchivadze, stamps, signatures, office duties paid. This administrative sleight of hand may have normalized Balanchine's birth, but it did nothing to change the facts. If Gyorgy's parents ever did formally marry, no record has been found, it was not, at least in Meliton's case, for the first time. When Gyorgy and his siblings were born, Meliton had a whole other family, a wife and two children back in his native Georgia. Many years later, Balanchine would wistfully tell his first biographer that this unnamed and faceless first wife, whom he never met, had died, and that his father had been a widower. But she hadn't, and he wasn't. The matter was serious, if not unusual. There were growing numbers of illegitimate children in St. Petersburg in these years, as peasant women, scarves wrapped tightly around their heads and carrying their belongings, fled their villages for new opportunities in nearby urban centers. Marital traditions loosened their hold on these and other urban mothers, townswomen, craftswomen, women filling jobs in businesses and factories. Gyorgy's mother perhaps among them, who found themselves at once independent and vulnerable in new ways. Official shelters called angel factories even paid 2 rubles per head for abandoned babies in an effort to absorb the increase in children left by their often struggling and unwed mothers. Even for those with the advantages of rank or wealth, the consequences could be serious. Illegitimacy precluded the inheritance of family wealth. Pierre's problem in the early pages of Tolstoy's War and Peace. Alexander Herzen's problem in Life. Wealth was not a Balanchivadze problem, at least for now, and nobility was out of the question. If you are noble, Balanchine later said, you always want to find out where you come from. My French so-and-so, my mother was so-and-so. But they were simple people, nothing, not important. And so, at the moment of birth, there were already complications, uncertainties, revisions, and pasts that would never quite reveal themselves fully, or that later took on the aura of secrets and blank spaces in his mind. Balanchine may not have cared that he was officially illegitimate, or known that his parents later maneuvered to correct the record, but it was a fact of his parents' lives, and children always absorbed their parents' facts. Balanchine never had the confidence of his past, and when he looked back down the long corridor of his life to that distant point where it all began, he saw only shadows and vague outlines. I don't know, he would say when pressed, winding his voice around the question and trying to find something to fill the hole in his mind. Thus emerged the first truth of his life. The bedrock was sand. Meliton Antonovich Balanchivadze came from a clan of state peasants in the rural enclave of Banoja, just outside the small town of Kutaisi in western Georgia. You can go there today and meet the Balanchivadze descendants still living there and see the sprawling graveyard of Balanchivadze ancestors buried in fenced outdoor plots, each like a miniature home complete with a small graveside table to make visitors comfortable, since talking with the dead was part of life. You can read in the church records going back into the 19th century that Hosia was the father of Otia, who was the father of a monk and his brother, Kai Hosro, who married Tula, and together they bore Balanchine's grandfather, Amiron. The family were peasants, but they were rising, and this very Amiron pulled himself up from the unglamorous business of soil and dirt in one of the only ways possible at the time, the Russian Orthodox Church. He managed to attend seminary in Kutaisi and become a parish priest, a deacon even, and part of the white clergy, so he changed the Georgian Amiran to the more rushing-sounding Anton. Others in the family joined the more ascetic black clergy of celibate monks, the ancestral monk to begin with, and later an uncle whose investiture Balanchine would witness as a child. Anton married a local peasant girl, and together they produced Meliton, the first of several children, only four of whom would survive. Meanwhile, Anton was becoming something of a local leader, and his parishioners were apparently so partial to him that they built in his honor the small gray stone church of St. George, which sits high on a hill overlooking the cemetery and the village. Meliton was raised down the hill and across the dirt road in the shadow of St. George, and at the center of what was then a small and impoverished farming community. It mattered that it was St. George, who would be little Georgi's patron saint, too. And this modest church is the only firm structure that ties Balanchine to that dusty place in his family's past. St. George, whose image Balanchine would keep near him in icons all his life, lost his mother at age 10 and devoted himself to brave military feats in the name of God. In his martyrdom, he was Christ-like and is said to have suffered tortures including a caustic lime pit, iron hooks, and being crushed by stone, broken on a wheel, and burned with a torch. An angel often protected him. St. George famously appeared in paintings and icons, riding a white horse and radiating light as he speared an evil dragon worshipped by terrified pagans and saved the beautiful maiden they had offered in sacrifice to this vicious beast. The maiden then led the dying dragon to the town center, where St. George slew it for all to see, a performance that freed the damsel and her people and brought them to the Christian faith. The village of Banoja sits in the narrow valley of the Rioni River near the town of Kutaisi and some 143 miles west of Tbilisi at the foot of the greater Caucasus Mountains. The Caucasus are the highest range in Europe and stretch from the Black Sea to the Caspian Sea, setting Kutaisi, Tbilisi, and the whole of Georgia dramatically, at times violently, apart from Russia and its capital of St. Petersburg, where Balanchine would be born and raised. Some thought of Georgia as Russia's southern Siberia, since the only way in from the north was over a perilous military highway with hairpin curves through a rocky and beautiful wooded mountain pass, a region romanced in tales by Pushkin and Lermontov. Since the early 19th century, the entire region had been forcibly incorporated into Russia and its diverse, fractured, and at times warring regions, ruled by the vast and Byzantine administrative structures of the czar. From the imperial point of view, there was no such thing as Georgia, and the censors forbade even the use of the word, at least in Russian. Education was in Russian, not Georgian, which has its own beautifully ornate alphabet, and the church was the Russian Orthodox Church, not the far more ancient Georgian Orthodox Church, with its deep pagan influences and ties to antiquity. This was the Georgia that Meliton was born to, and as a child, he naturally began walking his father's path. He had been baptized in the nearby Kutaisi Cathedral, and like his father, he was educated at the Kutaisi Seminary, his grades in all subjects, Russian, Latin, Greek, arithmetic, and spiritual history, were low. And although he went on to the more prestigious Tiflis Theological Seminary in Georgia's capital city at the age of 14, he soon dropped out and returned to Kutaisi to marry Gayane Eristavi, a local girl from an old but impoverished noble family. The couple had two children, Nino and Apollon, and for a moment, Meliton appeared set to continue on the family path through a life that would end in the little Banoja cemetery under the Church of St. George with his ancestors all around. As it turned out, however, this was only Meliton's first family. Balanchine belonged to Meliton's second Russian family and a whole new life. Nino and Apollon were Balanchine's distant half-sister and half-brother, a fact that Balanchine barely knew. He never met Nino, but as a young child he would briefly meet Apollon, who was 22 years older, in St. Petersburg, though Balanchine later rarely mentioned him. Friends and dancers close to Balanchine in the American years of his life were shocked to meet this unexpected relation, who appeared at his side during the NYCB's 1962 tour to Tbilisi. "This is my brother," Balanchine blankly noted as he presented this forgotten man, who had been wasted from years in a Soviet political prison before taking up the family mantle of priest. It was history and an ample dose of wanderlust that broke Meliton's family and set him on a new path. Meliton had been born a year after the watershed liberation of the serfs across Russia in 1861, an event as momentous and flawed as the end of slavery in the United States. He came of age with the resulting back-to-the-people movement of artists and writers drawn to peasant traditions of music, dance, and art. At the same time, the Russian authorities in Georgia were trying forcibly to erase these traditions in the name of a unified Russian homeland. Tension mounted as loyalty to the Russian language and to a host of increasingly rigid political and cultural practices dictated from distant offices in St. Petersburg became more and more difficult for local Georgians to sustain. Even for those like Meliton and his family, who were loyal to the Tsar, and to their own advancement in the Russian state apparatus. Complicating matters, industrialization, railways, and urbanization were fast changing the landscape, and Meliton was part of a larger flow of poor and displaced peasants and people of various ranks in search of opportunities moving into Kutaisi, Tiflis, later Tbilisi, and other rapidly growing towns and urban centers. The seminaries at Kutaisi and especially Tiflis were known as stepping stones to higher position and stature in the Russian system. But by the time Meliton arrived, the Tiflis seminary in particular was also becoming a breeding ground for a growing Georgian nationalist ressentiment. The seminary had been especially harshly Russianized. Georgian icons stripped from church walls and destroyed. Georgian history summarily banished from the syllabus. Life inside the walls of the stone sack, as the students none too fondly called the massive neoclassical building, was strict. Students were occupied from dawn until late in the evening with classes and rehearsals, and Sundays were spent standing for hours in long Orthodox services. Meliton joined the seminary choir and took up chanting, one of Georgia's oldest musical and religious traditions, at the ancient Sioni Cathedral, not far from the seminary. None of this rigor or religiosity prevented a growing dissent. Secret reading circles, urgent cultural and political meetings, and heated debates multiplied as resistance to the repressive Russian state hardened. A few years after Meliton left, the seminary would become the intellectual training ground for another poor peasant boy recently arrived from the neighboring town of Gori, Joseph Stalin. Meliton fell under the influence of the work of the poets Akaki Zeriteli and Ilya Chachavadze, leading figures in the growing Georgian national awakening. Music was his greatest talent. So Meliton abandoned any aspirations to a life in the clergy and instead busily devoted himself to a flurry of Georgian musical pursuits that would come to characterize his life. With his young family stationed in Kutaisi, he took up work in opera and organized his own touring ethnographic choir that performed in traditional Georgian dress. Pictures show him handsomely posed in a dapper European suit and tie, A sign of social stature, no matter Georgian national sentiment, amid his swarthy, black-booted, belted, and sabered all-male choir of Georgian musicians. Meanwhile, like so many composers of his generation, Melitón was traversing the countryside, collecting and transcribing folk songs. But in a sign of his simultaneous admiration for more westernized Russian musical traditions, he also sometimes doctored these local compositions by turning wildly dissonant Georgian trichords into more civilized Western classical triads. He even wrote his own songs. Balanchine would too, and set to music the poetry of Tseriteli and Chachavadze. Georgia and Georgian music became his life. It was a restless and ambitious time, and Melitón soon wanted to go to St. Petersburg to further his musical studies. His younger brother, Vaso, was already there studying painting with the renowned Ilya Repin, another leader in the Back to the People movement. To pay for his trip, Melitón tirelessly raised money by putting on shows with friends, and in 1889, at the age of 27, he left his Georgian wife and two small children, ages 3 and 5, crossed the forbidding Caucasus Mountains, and made his way to the capital of Alexander III's Imperial Russia. He moved in with Vaso and politely petitioned as the son of a priest to enroll in a composition class at the St. Petersburg Conservatory of Music with Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov, drawn no doubt by the composer's works based on folk and fairy tales. Rimsky-Korsakov had been a founding member of the mighty little heap of Russian composers fully trained in Western musical traditions, but devoted to developing a distinctly national musical style rooted in the ancient cultures of the Asian steppe, the Caucasus, and points east. He had just premiered his colorful Scheherazade. Alexander III was setting his own neo-nationalist tone in the capital city, and turning his Russia sharply against the Europeanizing instincts of St. Petersburg and his more cultivated father, who had been assassinated by anarchists in 1881. His son was burly, awkward, carelessly educated. His brother had been the heir apparent but had suddenly died, and he despised the French-inspired etiquette and what he called the endless cotillion of the St. Petersburg elite. He proudly declared himself a Muscovite and thought of himself as a true Russian, Slavic, Orthodox, and committed above all to the sanctity of his own autocratic rule. He set about changing the look of the country, in part by building new churches, new monasteries, and new convents, including the garish onion-domed Church of the Savior on the Spilled Blood in St. Petersburg, erected on the site of his father's murder, and a deliberate affront to the city's otherwise elegantly restrained European architectural style. Balls at the Winter Palace took on Muscovite themes, and officers and members of his guards were even encouraged to grow bushy beards, eschewing the long-standing Petrine regulations mandating a clean-shaven Western look. Epaulettes, sabers, armor were out. Caftans, Russian caps, and jackboots were in. Icons and crosses were added to flagstaffs. And Alexander doted like a proud father on the children of his great empire. His coronation ceremonies included Russia's nationalities: Georgians, Finns, Cossacks, Poles, and others performing their own native dances in traditional costumes around a beautiful central woman, Rus. Melitón was in his element. Impatient with the rigors of a conservatory education, he eventually abandoned his musical studies and instead threw himself headlong into recreating his Georgian musical life. Georgian evenings, Georgian singing groups, theater, opera, dinners, parties. He started work on the first Georgian opera, Veli Tamara, from an epic poem by Tseriteli about Georgia's beloved medieval emeriti queen, the seductive and strong ruler of Georgia at its cultural peak. Always short of money, Meliton managed to win support from Prince K.I. Bagraton Mukharansky of the Georgian royal family and a dynastic relation to the mythic Tamara. He did not complete the opera until much later, but got far enough to stage an excerpt at the prestigious Hall of Nobles in 1897. It was a formal affair, just the kind he liked, with champagne and endless toasts, elegant food, and couples in colorful national costume, a Georgian version of the Russian balls so fashionable at the time, in which guests set their Parisian finery aside and arrayed themselves instead in traditional Russian dress of the past, embroidered and brightly colored. For all its claims to Georgianness, however, Meliton's opera, like so much of his St. Petersburg life, was performed in Russian. Balanchine remembered his father this way. He didn't do anything, not serious. He was a good speaker, always invited his guest to speak at parties, for flowery speech, beautiful, things like that. In the course of it all, Meliton managed to achieve a certain social stature. As an artist, he was awarded the title of Hereditary Honorable Citizen, even though he officially belonged to the raznochinstni, or people of various ranks, a catch-all administrative category for accomplished freemen who were not quite socially elevated enough to make it onto Peter the Great's all-important table of ranks. The table, which had been invented in the early 18th century and would endure until the revolution abolished it, established a hierarchy of civil and military ranks that formed the backbone of the Russian political order. It was a way of controlling the elite by destabilizing its members. Power and upward mobility, and especially the coveted titles of nobility, along with valuable privileges such as exemption from military service or the capitation tax, depended on loyalty to the state and the personal favor of the czar rather than on birth alone. And while the highest ranks were largely occupied by the hereditary nobility, it was possible to step into the lower ranks and to climb. At least in theory, Meliton, little peasant boy Meliton, the lowly son of a parish priest from Banoja, had half a chance. But only half. The people of various ranks were also seen as outsiders, dismissed by many above them as upstarts. And the most anxious and unstable category in an already unstable order. Everyone knew that these were people who might one day rise, but they were far more likely to tumble down the social and economic ladder into the dreaded dark masses below. They constituted a precarious middling social group, part of Russia's notoriously underdeveloped middle class that included non-noble civil servants, scholars, townspeople, merchants, and artists. The hereditary prefix and hereditary honorable citizen was important, since it made clear that Meliton's children, assuming they were legitimate, would inherit his status, which was not always the case with the honorable citizen category. It made Meliton marginally more secure, a small rung up and a sign of his ambition and respectable standing. We don't know how Meliton met Balanchine's mother, Maria Nikolaevna Vasilieva, a fragile, porcelain-looking woman with a remote demeanor and shy, inwardly focused eyes. Nor do we know much about her, except that she loved music and was deeply religious. Meliton affectionately called her Gogosha, bridging his worlds by mixing the Georgian word for girl with the Russian diminutive. She was 11 years his junior. But Balanchine thought the gap was 25 years, and he pictured his father as perennially old and his mother as warm and delicate. Blonde, small nose, very kind, small, soft woman, very nice. No, she was absolutely calm and soft and did not ask anybody to do anything. Later, his brother gave him photos, which show her fine features and gentle frame and her solidly bourgeois self-presentation, ribbons and cinched crinoline, stiff bows, delicate lace or a patterned blouse, high collars, and wispy blonde hair pulled softly back. Like people in a Chekhov play, Balanchine recalled, implying dress but also an underlying melancholy. According to her children's birth certificates, Maria was a former craftswoman and the daughter of a merchant of the Tsarskoye-Selskaya Second Merchants Guild in the well-heeled Tsarskoye Selo area of St. Petersburg. The guild generally included men in retail trade, shop owners, small factory owners, and anyone of professional standing who could afford the steep fees, which meant that she too belonged to the striving social universe of the people of various ranks, notoriously susceptible to rank mania and acutely aware of the symbols and trappings of status, clothing, education, wealth, the right address, the right church, the right society. Maria told her children that her father was one Baron Nicholas von Almedingen, a German businessman who abandoned his Russian family and returned to Germany, at which point her mother, she said, gave Maria her name, Vasileva. Maybe it was true or partly true or not true at all. The records of Maria's birth and ancestry are nowhere to be found. In spite of diligent scholarly research in the vast Russian archives, and although it is true that the Almedingens, a notable family of writers, officials, and military men, do later appear in Balanchivadze letters and lives, there seems to be no mention of Maria and their recorded history. Whatever her lineage, Maria had sisters, at least one by a different father. They appear as constant fixtures in the few recovered family letters and memories. Aunt Nadezhda, Aunt Anya, Aunt Milia, Aunt Sopya, who was a documented daughter of an Almedingen and a close companion to Maria, especially in her later years. These sisters were the closest family Maria seems to have had, although among them, Balanchine only really remembered Nadezhda. Her family name, same my mother, Vasileva, same mothers, two daughters, two different fathers. They were sisters, but different names, one called Maria Nikolaevna, the other Nadira Vasileva. Nadezhda attended the Oldenburg Institute, a primary technical school to age 13 for children of all classes, founded by the Duke and Duchess Alexander of Oldenburg, who also sponsored hospitals, orphan asylums, and other charitable institutions. These were disciplined, hierarchical, and insular places, much like Meliton's seminary or the ballet school Maria would later choose for her son, emphasizing obedience and fine manners. Nadezhda's name appears on the student lists, and family lore says Maria went there too, but she is missing from the school's official ranks, which may account for her childish hand and uncertain spelling and grammar. The literacy rate of urban women, including aristocrats, still hovered around 38% just before the turn of the century. We are left a shadowy and unstable world. Balanchine had none of the certainties of the aristocratic Nabokovs, Stravinskys, and other well-to-do white Russian artists he would later know, who grew up on well-appointed estates or were given a thorough education in Western literature, languages, and art, not to mention a strong sense of their own permanence in time and space. Illusory, it would turn out, but powerful nonetheless. His was a more far-flung heritage, uprooted and unstable, but also dynamic and full of surprises and unexpected turns. And one of the most unexpected came in 1901, just before Tamara, Georgi, and Andrei were born. That year, Maria Nikolaevna Vasilieva won the state lottery. Suddenly, they were rich. The prize was significant, an astonishing 200,000 rubles. It was a shocking piece of luck, especially since the lottery was talked about by everyone, but almost no one actually won. It had been created by the state in the 1860s to attract small investors to purchase moderately priced bonds, with the calculation that a very occasional large win would inspire people of modest means, such as Maria and Meliton, to gamble on the chance. It worked. And by the 1890s, the lottery had become a source of feverish gossip and giddy fantasies of instant wealth and happiness. Although Chekhov warned in his story, The Lottery Ticket, that such fantasies could also be ruinous. The annual drawing at the State Bank was a much-anticipated social event, with its large rotating drums churning bits of cardboard, each printed with a name and serial number, until the winning tickets were finally drawn and the winners' lives dramatically changed. Maria's unexpected winnings meant that her three children were not only illegitimate, but born into a world of fairy tale wealth and giddy expectations. The money, it seemed, belonged to Maria, who eventually included Meliton by power of attorney. Property and wealth were the only things a woman in Russia could own outright without the permission or oversight of a father or husband. As a woman, Maria otherwise had little independence. Women had no right to travel, reside alone, enroll in education, or take a job without a father or husband's approval. But even married women could own and manage their own property, including cash assets. And besides, at this point, Maria was technically single and by all accounts on her own. Rumors still cut through the family. Did Meliton, as his Georgian family lore would have it, even to the present day, rush to see a priest to erase his marriage to his Georgian wife and marry the now rich Maria instead? We don't really know, but probably not, since Gayane is later on record saying that Meliton sent support over the years and even paid for her to visit health spas. We do know that whatever the complications of their formal relations, Maria and Meliton wasted no time in spending the windfall. First, there was real estate, and the couple moved several times to various fancy addresses near the Smolny Cathedral in the northeast corner of the city, before they finally settled when the children were toddlers in a large 12-room apartment in an Art Deco building located on the wide, neatly cobblestoned Suvrovsky Prospect, named after the heroic general of the 1812 war. They were not far from the Nikolaevskaya Military Academy and the Suvorovsky Garden, formerly on the Suvorov family estate. To coachmen, we would say Suvorovsky Prospect near the academy, Balanchine said of one of his few clear memories of these early childhood years. Next came the dacha. In 1906, Maria purchased a plot of land in fashionable Lunajoki, a forested region dotted with clear lakes on the Karelian Peninsula in Russian-occupied Finland. It was some 3 hours by steam train from St. Petersburg-Finlansky station along the coast about halfway to Vyborg. Lunajoki was a popular region for summer homes among the St. Petersburg elite. And the little town boasted a modest station house where travelers could connect to a small steam tram that carried people to various destinations deep in the woods. The necessaries were within reach. There was a domed Orthodox monastery with a bell tower surrounded by a neat white picket fence, an old barn for summer theater, a post office, and a small bakery. Little Pine Woods, the plot was quaintly called, and in 1908, Maria added a second plot to the expanding family holdings. On the property, they built a large, rambling, two-story log house in a classic dacha style, with generous porches for long afternoons over the samovar, and a cozy rustic feel that evoked the warm Russian interiors and country life immortalized in War and Peace with Natasha's famous dance. The rest followed. In St. Petersburg, there was a staff of cooks and maids and wet nurses for the children. A professionally shot baby photograph shows Georgi lying in the ample lap of his wet nurse, a large young woman dressed in traditional Russian sarafan, with strings of pearls and an elaborate headdress, her milk thought to be a vital source of Russian soul. There was a German governess, another coveted attribute of stature, and a bow to Maria's supposed distinguished family roots. Meliton acquired a fancy gleaming coach and a handsome white horse, St. George, to complete their fairy tale life, except that it turned out to be a circus animal trained to rear onto its hind legs and prance to music, a trick that one afternoon toppled and wrecked this proud family chariot. The white horse mysteriously vanished. There were photographs of the three children taken at the Tony R. Charles studio, with branches on Nevsky Prospect and Vasilevsky Island. We can see them posed in freshly ironed sailor suits or white Cossack shirts, or elaborate harlequin costumes with bobble hats and long curling hair. At home, there were feasts, parties, and celebrations. And Meliton used some of the money to finance his Georgian musical soirees, along with a Georgian chorus. He even paid to have a friend and ethnomusicologist collect and edit the letters of Mikhail Glinka for the occasion of the 50th anniversary of the composer's death. Like Meliton, Glinka was fully versed in Western musical forms, and he, too, had incorporated folk themes into his compositions and organized, in his case, serf, choirs, and orchestras. Soon after Georgi's birth, Meliton's brother, Ivan, who was in the army, arrived with his Polish wife and lived with them for a time. Apollon, the lost Georgian half-brother Georgi barely knew, was pursuing a military career and visited, too. There were constant guests, and the company Meliton and Maria kept seems to have been a mix of artists and musicians, but also political figures, churchmen, and well-placed government officials. Georgi's godparents included very high-ranking men indeed. Konstantin Konstantinovich Stepanovich, fourth rank and a former vice governor of Georgia, who later joined the Interior Ministry and in 1908 served on Pyotr Stolypin's Agricultural Reform Commission. His father was dean of the imposing Kazan Cathedral off the Nevsky Prospect. Or Vasily Livovich Vilichko, fifth rank, who was Tamara's godfather. When he died, his cousin stepped in as Georgi's godfather. Vilichko was a Ukrainian-born nobleman and a poet and essayist who had worked with Meliton on an opera libretto. He had been the leader of a Russian nationalist literary group in the 1880s and 1890s, that included the philosopher and mystic Vladimir Soloviev, a key influence on artists and intellectuals fighting for a spiritual revolution. Vilichko was also a founding member of the darkly extremist Russian Assembly, which later shaded into the murderous Black Hundreds. We don't know if Meliton sympathized with Vilichko's virulently racist and anti-Semitic rhetoric, but we do know that, Vilichko aside, Meliton had many socialist friends, most of them doomed to tragic political fates. Balanchine later recalled his father's admiration for Arakli Seriteli, a Georgian social democrat who would serve in Alexander Kerensky's government and become a key player, with Meliton, in the short-lived Georgian Menshevik Republic in 1918, before fleeing to the West as the Bolsheviks swept their Menshevik cousins brutally aside. Or Nikolai Chedze, another Georgian Menshevik active in Petrograd and later in Tbilisi, he too would escape to Europe, where he committed suicide. Andrei also recalled long dinners and his father's friendship with the Georgian revolutionaries Mamia Ora Helishvili and Shalva Eliava, who would hold important positions in the Bolshevik government, when it came to power in Tiflis. Both were arrested and executed during Stalin's terror in 1937, just weeks before Meliton himself died there. It was a full and expansive house, and Meliton, on the rise, wasn't the kind of man to discriminate politically. Befitting a man of his newly assumed wealth and stature, Meliton began foolishly styling himself a businessman. He started by setting up a business importing Kakheti Georgian wines on the prosperous Liteyini Prospect, a commercial street busy with tram lines, carriages, and customers browsing shop fronts decorated with colorful pictures of the goods available inside. Further cementing his position, he joined the board of the 4th St. Petersburg Mutual Credit Association, a lending organization for entrepreneurs, and set about building a portfolio of financial investments, throwing himself headlong into Russia's chaotically industrializing economy. By the fall of 1910, he was in trouble, as his desperate letters to Maria prove. Anguished and writing from business trips in far-flung locations, Meliton nervously assured his wife that things would work out. He might be able to sell some land in Yalta, and that roof tile factory in Moscow would be okay, and the necessary graphite and sand would arrive in only 10 days, and the money should be guaranteed. This time, he promised, he would spend it only on a factory to manufacture foundry vats, of all things, and it was possible there would be more money from Georgi's godfather Stepanovich in Minsk. Meliton swears he will then come home and return to his music and everything will be all right. But he knows it won't. "I feel like I am throwing away my most precious thing, my family." He was playing the odds, gambling, really, and the luck that had won them the lottery in the first place never returned. And so, the wealth that Georgi and his siblings had been born into quietly vanished. Maria and Meliton let their prized St. Petersburg apartment go, and around 1910 moved the family permanently to the simpler Finland dacha. Maria sold a second plot of land there, too. But it was not enough. Meliton's mounting debts caught up with him, and he was taken under house arrest, says Andrei, or sent to debtor's prison, says Balanchine. Balanchine later imagined a dark Soviet-style plot, saying his father was betrayed by friends, who gave evidence against him and landed him at the dreaded Kresty prison, a cruel and ironically cross-shaped facility in St. Petersburg, later immortalized by Anna Akhmatova, who stood for 300 long hours at the hard doors to hear word of her son arrested by Stalin's henchmen. Wherever Meliton was confined, his sudden disappearance had an air of eerie secrecy. Maria told Georgi his father was collecting folk songs in the countryside, the kind of well-intentioned lie no child believes, and the whole episode was so confusing that Balanchine later thought his father had been gone for 2 years, even though it was probably a matter of months. Indeed, not long after his desperate letters to Maria, the irrepressible Meliton seems to have been back in Georgia celebrating his 50th birthday, drinking wine and delivering flowery toasts with friends and family in Kutaisi. Balanchine recalled his father's return from debtor's prison quite differently. In a gilded memory, he saw his handsome father slowly walking up the path to the porch of their home in Lunajogi to his children and beautiful waiting wife. he was carrying a single red rose, a story Andre flatly denied. Chapter 2. Icons of Childhood. Sand was building on sand, and his childish memories, including things Balanchine saw but didn't know he saw, piled on top of what we know or think we know about what really happened. In his mind, everything about his distant past later pooled into a single sentence. "Oh yes, we were very happy," he quietly said of his childhood, and he had lots of rose-colored memories to prove it. In St. Petersburg, he remembered Christmas and a church plunged in total darkness until the choir sang and candles shone on the magnificently bejeweled priests and altar boys in their glittering brocade vestments. He remembered how he wore velvet to the annual Christmas party in the Grand Hall of Nobles, and never forgot the city's enormous and fantastically decorated tree, and how the children all played games such as leapfrog and rushiok, a scene he would later reproduce in the Nutcracker. He remembered how at home there was a glorious tree, too, with the smell of pine and candle wax, decorated with gold paper angels and stars, silver tinsel rain, and fat glass pears that didn't break if they fell. There were trips to Eliseyev's vast emporium on the corner of Nevsky Prospect, a palatial Art Deco building with stained glass panels, bronze statuary, and lavish window displays of delicious candies and fruits. Inside, there were vaulting ceilings and chandeliers and sawdust-covered floors that muffled the footfall of customers as they browsed the delicacies imported from around the world. Eliseyev, a successful wine merchant, had even built a small theater with tall windows and a modest stage for operettas on the second floor. And of course, there were Meliton's shining white horse and carriage, Suvorovsky near the academy, and walks he was told he took as a boy with his governess in the beautifully cultivated formal gardens nearby. It was said that he sat on a bench on the neatly groomed park path, close to a man who waited patiently until the small boy had played and gone before he threw his concealed bomb, killing a nearby target. The bomb was an example of the things Balanchine didn't notice or remember, except as something vaguely ominous. He didn't recall the overcrowding and filth in the streets, the sewage dumped into cesspools in back alleyways, and the rickety wooden carts that arrived by night to collect the rotting and stinking refuse, or the large signs in menacing red letters in public places warning against the drinking water as cholera and TB outbreaks routinely swept the city. He was too young to fully register the mounting unrest and violence, the strikes and protests, the seemingly random attacks, bombs, assassination attempts, gunshots launched by anarchists, black hundreds, and extremist factions on the left and right, some in the pay of the Tsar's secret police. And he couldn't have known about the weakening, languishing power of the great Tsar himself in a Russia that had faced humiliating defeat at war with Japan, immediately followed by the suicidal events of Bloody Sunday in 1905, when His Majesty ordered his troops to fire on his very own people, priests, families, women, and children, as they marched peacefully from strategic points across the city to the Winter Palace, floating Orthodox flags and singing hymns to their Tsar father. Balanchine may not have known, but children absorbed their surroundings, and the deteriorating atmosphere of St. Petersburg was silently imprinted like a menacing drumbeat onto his, "Oh yes, we were very happy," early years. And as he separated the memories out over the course of his life, like wheat from chaff, all that was good and warm and childhood seemed to slide into the imperial side of the ledger, and all that was violent, anguished, and upsetting piled up in a heap around the dark incidents that eventually led to the most inescapable destructions of all: war and revolution. But his light-suffused memories stayed with him. They were the jewels he would sew into the hem of his mind and carry with him out of Russia. He had to remember them because no one else would. He took no family with him, and he had no relations to tell him the stories of his life, so he developed the habit of holding it all inside. And if these memories, so carefully and balletically constructed in his mind, have a whiff of romance and untruth, what matter? He was building his repertory, and who else was there to say otherwise? At home, it took only two chairs set side by side to make a church altar. Balanchine remembered playing the priest in imaginary robes with his siblings, blessing parishioners and reciting whole portions of the service word for word by heart. He stood for hours with his mother and aunt in stone churches on Sundays, and especially for the long Easter midnight services. Year after year, he watched the mysterious cloth imprinted with the image of Christ, laid in the center of the church on an altar or table of flowers. He delighted in the merriment when the cloth was lifted and the lights flooded, and he walked by his mother's side as people hugged each other and joyfully processed and sang, "Christ is risen." He recalled his awe, too, at a special service in the cavernous Kazan Cathedral for the tonsure of a Georgian relative, who protracted himself dramatically on the hard floor with a black cloak thrown over his body. Already he was out of this world, Balanchine later recalled. The cloak was then ritually pulled from the inert man, who rose and became, magically, a monk or bishop. Georgi himself eventually became an altar boy, eligible finally for the coveted brocade vestments. He remembered, too, the little church in Finland and the walk to the tiny tram down the road from their house that took the family to worship on Sundays. And so the Orthodox faith, with its ritual, beauty, and music, took its given place in his mind. Belief was not a choice. It was a fact of his life from the moment his name was recorded in the church registry. Images and icons, especially, were there from his earliest years right up to his last moments, set in the high corners of Russian houses, or later in portable frames propped up on tables in the various apartments he occupied in New York. When he died, his assistant found a small, carefully mounted bishop's staff on his bedside table, along with icons of St. George and St. Nicholas, and a blessing crucifix. Balanchine's relationship to the organized Orthodox Church was occasional, and his spiritual beliefs often took a mystical turn, but still, the practices of the church, its liturgy and aesthetic, were among the greatest legacies of his childhood, part of the architecture of his imagination. And if we think of Balanchine's childhood as the formation of a mind as well as an accumulation of experiences, icons in particular were key. They gave him one of his first visual languages, a way to see. Icons are flat and two-dimensional. They show us images of saints and other venerated figures or biblical scenes, but they have none of the seductive emotional drama and storytelling of Catholic art. There are no bodies bent in anguish, no bloodied and burdened Christ, no faces clenched in mourning. Instead, these figures are bloodless and eternal, impassive and immobile. Flatness indicates immateriality, and everything about the flesh and the carnal state is excluded, giving the iconic figure the weightlessness of shades or angels or dancers. They have bodies, but they are transfigured, the purified and illuminated corporeality of the divine. Icons have no source of light, which means no shadows, just as there are no shadows in the kingdom of God. The light emanates from within, and iconographers like to say that the background of an icon is light itself. All of this immateriality, even though an icon itself is a material object to approach, touch, look at, see. Moreover, icons use inverse perspective. Western traditions of perspective bring the viewer into a painting by guiding the eye from the picture's surface to a distant horizon. But icons do the reverse. The horizon is turned back onto the worshiper, and the icon is designed to reach out and pull him into its midst, to cross over into the divine. Mary or Christ or Saint George is not experienced as narrative. Everyone already knows their stories, but instead as a non-logical and non-verbal visual experience. In the image, everything unfolds at once in its immensity, and practitioners yearning to cross to the other side come up close to an icon, face to face, leaning, forehead on the image, kissing it, concentrating on it, seeing it even with closed eyes. It is not the image itself that is the focus, but the realer-than-real figure or world accessed through the window or lens of the icon. The experience is sensual and total rather than intellectual or chronological. Icons that have been especially prayed before are considered a more effective gateway because you are united not only with heaven, but with all those who have stood and offered their prayers before this image. Also, icons are never signed. Iconographers, like priests, are in service to God, and the whole process of making an icon, the discipline and obedience to a prescribed set of rules and rituals, is designed to remove the eye from the experience. Icons are never self-expression, nor are they original. What man could presume to create the divine? And even though iconographers work from past images and are bound by tradition and witness, an icon is not a copy of a past icon. The hand of man on paint, oil, resin is admitted and recognized, even if the eye of the ego is not. Each has its own integrity, and like a Greek chorus, icons are part of life. They watch, they judge, they see, and they can elicit good and exact vengeance. Couples cover them when they have sex. Icons were part of Balanchine's inner life, and they bring to mind many things he would later say of his dances and how he made them. But Finland. In many ways, Finland, where the family ended up when the wealth had faded, was Balanchine's best childhood of all. Luna Jogi was a midsummer night forest of towering pine and birch, with willow trees, mosses, and dozens of varieties of mushrooms. His mother taught him a song to distinguish the poisonous types, and he set out to hunt and dig in the woods, which tinkled with the bells that mothers attached to their children to know they could always be found. There were plump yellow pineapple strawberries and large black huckleberries made into sweet jams and pies. He recalled planting in the sprawling garden with the chickens and a pig who became a companion, very intelligent, until it was finally killed and served to him at a dinner he refused to eat. There were arduous walks to the lakes several miles away and long summer white nights. In winter, there was deep snow and a sleigh and bells and skis to carry you over the heaping 15-foot drifts. There was a shaggy white dog to put on the sleigh and a brother, a sister, a German nanny, and a mustached university student in a black cap and coat who tutored the children and played croquet in the garden. Books did not figure much, but his mother did read them fairy tales. There was a sauna he hated, he ran from the heat and steam, and a piano he loved. Georgi played four hand pieces with Andre, and his mother played too. The children organized shows and concerts, just as the families of Tchaikovsky, Nabokov, Tolstoy, and Stravinsky did on their summer estates in the timeless world of Russian aristocratic country life. Tamara created costumes and sets while Georgi and Andre designed musical programs. What would you like to hear? When his father was home, but also back in St. Petersburg before the money was gone, they all played and sang Georgian folk songs, including the spiritual You Are a Vineyard. and when guests came, as they often did, especially when Meliton was present, there were traditional table songs to accompany the lengthy and impassioned Georgian toasts. Or all those gathered sang urban songs from Kutaisi and Tiflis that sounded a bit like opera, and sometimes the family played gramophone records of old Italian singers. If there was dancing, as there was at Christmas, André remembered Jolia, as he fondly called Georgi, hanging back, shy and watchful, or hiding in a corner to avoid being asked to perform. He kicked and flailed his arms at anyone who disturbed his anonymity. The children learned three-part singing, polyphony, and the competitive improvisation typical of Georgian folk music, with singers and children vying to outdo one another. In this tradition, there was little unison or solo singing, and a song would be performed instead by three voices, usually male and of solo caliber. Repetition was avoided and innovation prized, so that performances of a known song were rarely the same. The singers were considered the author, and the composers of folk songs were anonymous or lost to time. The three voices generally moved in close musical proximity, and improvisation, the children quickly learned, was not freestyle. There were strict musical rules and conventions, and the three-part voice structure naturally limited individual freedom. You can't go far when two others depend on you. Besides, the performers were there to serve the text, which, a bit like Icons or Balanchine's dances, required a restrained and unemotional approach, even to highly emotional music. Don't act, just sing or play the music well, and the rest will follow. All of this would later serve Balanchine in his dances. These convivial and brightly lit memories stalled against the everyday fact that Meliton was often gone. Not around very much, I don't know, on business. I don't know where he went, little bit with us, sometimes he goes away, I don't know, trying to find a job, I don't know. And finally, father didn't live with us. So it was a home of women and children, which made his mother sad, he said, but she was okay, maybe, and in any case, she ran the busy household herself with the help of an occasional aunt. She was like that, a woman who, in spite of her eggshell appearance, seems to have possessed the necessary inner strength to manage her maternal duties, her wayward husband, her staff and children, and her own peculiar fate. A once rich little poor girl, everything now squandered, alone in the absence of any evident parents of her own. Meliton was forgiven, his absences and poor financial judgment, forgiven his flighty headlong preoccupation with whatever was next in his line of business or musical pursuits. He left his son Georgi with one lasting gift, Georgia. It was a difficult gift, imaginary, really, since Balanchine was only ever there briefly on State Department tours in 1962 and 1972, long after his father and mother were gone. The facts sometimes blurred in his telling, but people close to him, including one of his wives, later swore he told them he was born and raised in Georgia. My tribe, he liked to say as he aged, turning the pages of a large old Georgian book he kept in his small eclectic library on the shelves of his office at the New York State Theater. He once sketched himself in traditional Georgian dress, saber drawn, fiercely baring his teeth, performing a lezginka or perhaps a warrior dance. What Balanchine gained from the idea of Georgia and the fact of Lunajoki was a point on the map where he could locate himself that was not Russia. It was an outsider stance, passive and a way of belonging nowhere, since he would never really have Georgia and would soon lose Lunajoki. Meliton was Georgian, and Georgia was truly his home. But his son was a Petersburger by birth and by fate, and St. Petersburg's open window on the west offered him a European orientation, another imagined place on the map and in his mind opposed to the Russian, become Soviet, behemoth. He was sunk into the imperial world and into its illusions and sights, smells and sounds, the sensual recall of which was all the more intense for being ephemeral. Gogol Mogol, 6 egg yolks, 6 tablespoons sugar, 1/2 teaspoon vanilla, cooked to a froth, chilled, and served in spoonfuls to her 3 children in the evenings. It was a comfort food custard thought to have medicinal qualities, originating in the Caucasus and among Central European Jews. Georgi loved it. And Maria's summer garden of potatoes, carrots, cabbage, cucumbers fed them into the winter as they salted the cabbages and made sauerkraut with caraway and stored it underground until it was translucent, Balanchine remembered, like immense beige tissue paper roses. There were pickled cucumbers and mushrooms placed in a large barrel with salt, pepper, bay leaf, and onion, all left to cure. When the vegetables were ready, the children would scoop a large mushroom, add a dollop of sour cream, and eat it. There were eggs that Balanchine later prepared, like Mama used to, at his own little lunajoki-like dacha in Weston, Connecticut. Buttered pieces of pumpernickel mixed with eggs, salt, pepper, and dill, cheese on top, cooked until they set and the cheese melted. There were blinis and on rare occasions caviar, mamenka, mamenka, caviar, caviar, and candies carefully locked in cupboards, distributed to deserving children, or trips to St. Petersburg, where Eliseyevs carried chocolate, rope, flour, wax, soap, sugar, coffee, candy, and they all shopped together with Maria, who didn't buy too much sugar because it was so dear. Was it true, as Balanchine later told one dancer, that he liked to take a small Georgian dagger and hide it in a book or a shoe, and when he was scolded, go secretly to his mother's Persian rug and cut out the elaborate patterns with the knife but leave them carefully in place, so that when the rug was taken up to be beaten and aired, the pieces all suddenly fell out to his delight? Or that his nanny taught him a little too much about sex, like one of Stravinsky's governesses, who was fired for wanting to gaze too intently upon the children in the bath? Or that as an adult, he felt forever guilty for never thanking his mother for the wristwatch she had once given him at great sacrifice to her ever-tightening budget? This one he remembered clearly. One afternoon, he walked into the little nearby barn theater where the children were sometimes taken to local performances. When he arrived, it was closed, but he somehow found a way to scramble underneath, and by chance, he reached a crawl space and managed to push his way up through what turned out to be the trap door. He emerged, like a wily character in a play, and found himself standing alone, center stage, staring into the theater. It was deserted, so he paused to take in the space, which stood expectantly before him. As he moved through the building, he came upon the dressing rooms and the perfumed scent of powder and fresh makeup. When he was later telling this story, his mind traveled at the same moment to how, as a child, he liked to dress up in girls' clothing. Absolutely, and now you could think that it would be probably perverse, like sissy, but probably I liked girls and wanted to put dress on me. Probably something screwy about that, too, that Freud would analyze, he mischievously said. And then his mind moved to how he and his brother would sit in bed at night in their shared bedroom, Tamara had her own, talking about the great seductive beauty of the local woman dentist. Happy may be the wrong word. Alone, a bit secretive, content, perhaps, with his own inner world and the pleasures of food and nature that his mother and the countryside provided. Quiet, closed in and dry, Andre said, a watcher. Even photographs show something silent and removed in Georgi's upright, childish demeanor. He had Maria's distant eyes and slightly pursed lips, and the long, bald, high forehead of his father, but slightly lifted, which made him seem to look down on everything from a summit. It was a quality people who knew him would remark upon his whole life. He was simple, charming, but remote and deeply reserved, except at the theater, where he was open and animated, like his voice when he tells of coming up through the trap door into the feeling of an empty stage and the smells of powder and makeup. These are the moments he cares about. The rest was fine, okay, monotone, we were happy, I suppose. Family life. Early one morning in August 1913, Maria took Tamara, age 11, and Georgi, age 9, to St. Petersburg. Andre was only 7 and may have tagged along. The first stop was the Imperial Cadet Corps, the Tsar's elite officer training school, and one of the few imperial institutions that allowed entry to children of lower social standing and promised almost certain advancement. Meliton and Maria were still trying to rise and wanted Georgi to have a place, but he failed to be admitted that day. Next, Tamara was scheduled to audition to become a dancer at the Imperial Theater School, another sure path to social advancement, since students at the school were in immediate service to the court and the Tsar. It was her second year trying, and Balanchine later defensively explained in some detail and with residual anger that Tamara simply did not have the necessary protection in high places to help her through the grueling audition process in which as many as 100 little girls vied for a few precious spots. Meliton had been working behind the scenes for a year, trying to use his connections to secure his daughter a place, begging closely placed people he knew to have a word with the director on his daughter's behalf. But he did not succeed. Tamara, too, failed to be admitted that day. While she was failing, Georgi was blindsided. The moment the school administrators saw him, a boy, they added him to the examination pool. And so he joined the children gathered in the large waiting area, where they were soon paired off and lined up to go to the infirmary. Each was asked to undress completely to be examined alone by a doctor. Georgi was carefully checked for a strong heart, good eyes, essential to navigating a brightly lit stage in a pre-contact lens era, straight spine and strong legs, not bowed or knock-kneed. Immunizations were scrutinized, and a note signed by Dr. Y. Isfakevich and added to George Balanchivadze's file referred to the two scars on his left shoulder, proof of smallpox vaccination. Those who failed any part of the medical examination were sent home. Those who remained, Georgi among them, filed in pairs into a large dance studio for the next part of the examination. A panel of artists from the Imperial Theater, elegantly dressed and seated facing the children behind a large imposing table, greeted them. The prospective students were called upon to walk, run, and skip past the judges, who might stop one or another child to examine his natural grace or physical proportions. Some were asked to place their heels together to affirm once again that the legs and knees were straight and in correct anatomical order. Georgi's demeanor apparently stood out, and he was asked to walk across the room by himself. His slight physique, straight posture, and calm exterior made him a natural candidate. He was just the kind of blank physical slate they were looking for. Finally, there were basic tests in reading, writing, and arithmetic. When it was all over, Georgi Melitonovich Balanchivadze was accepted on the spot. A few days later, on August 13th, Meliton wrote officially to the inspector of the school with the necessary humble petition for entrance, enclosing the required birth certificate, passport, and record of smallpox vaccination. By then, Georgi was already in the hands of the imperial court. Immediately following his successful audition, he was taken to have his hair cut to regulation length, uniform fitted and bed assigned. His mother, sister, and brother left that same day, and Andre recalled his brother's bitter tears as they departed. Georgi went to sleep alone in the large dormitory room in the boys' wing, with its neat rows of beds occupied by strangers. It was an anguished and empty moment for a small child, and he could never quite make sense of it emotionally. The ground had shifted too abruptly one day to the next, and Lunajoki and his mother, which had seemed so timeless, were suddenly gone. It felt like a betrayal, but perhaps above all, a humiliation. How could they? 50 years later, he was still angry and hurt, even though his entrance to the Imperial Theater School that day had by then proven to be the gateway to an astonishing subsequent life and career. They just left me there, like you take a dog and leave it. Chapter 3, War and Peace. He was only 9, but when Georgi arrived at the Imperial Theater School on that warm August day in 1913, his first childhood ended and a second began. Like a dog was less the rage of a powerless boy against the will of a mother than a way of saying just how fast and far he had been dropped out of one life and into another. Everything had been traded. Mother for minder, hearth for school, Russian country life for the discipline and routines of a Europeanized imperial court art. There were simply no continuities, except the sense he would make of it all inside. The world and the profession Georgi was now entering were governed by two imposing facts that would reveal themselves to him over time. The first was the imperial court, and the second was the war. The court was the blueprint for Russian ballet, and anyone who grew up in its midst was silently initiated into its strange past. It had all begun with Peter the Great's ambitious Europeanizing project that had brought French and Italian ballet to Russia in the first place. This was not a mere matter of cultural borrowing. It was a human engineering project on a mass scale, unrivaled in scope and ambition until the Bolshevik Revolution that finally overthrew it, making Russians into Europeans. Under Peter and his successors, uniforms, ranks, and St. Petersburg's architectural style, food, gestures, etiquette, and language were all foreign and European. Czars, from that point forth, customarily married foreign princesses, and it was no accident that Nicholas II's wife was both German and a granddaughter of Queen Victoria, or that French was the lingua franca at court right up to the revolution. Ballet was part of this project. With its Italian and French origins, it provided essential training in the etiquette, comportment, and gestures of the European nobility. Russianness didn't go away. Even the most palatial Europeanized homes, filled with imported marble, fine art, and crystal chandeliers, often had inner Russian sanctuaries with a warm fire, a samovar, and comfortable rugs. Some said the Russian psyche was similarly split. The real inner Russian soul hidden behind the external facade of European man. Becoming European was thus a highly theatrical enterprise. There were roles to practice and enact, lines to learn, and steps to memorize. The ballets and spectacles that ensued on the Russian stage were ritualized performances of this central premise of court life, one of the many ways that Russians rehearsed over and again the fantasy of foreignness governing their lives. Behind the court, or at its core, lay a deeper and colder historical fact that Georgi would have to absorb too. Serfdom and the peculiar institution of the serf ballerina. When Catherine the Great released the nobility from their duties at court in the late 18th century, many retreated to their often lavish country estates and set about making their own personal theatrical replicas of court hierarchies and the drama of acting European. On these estates, the masters played the czar and cast their serfs as their courtiers. They went to great lengths to train these serfs for their new and unfamiliar roles, importing European ballet masters, singing instructors, musicians, and poets to teach young serf girls in particular to act the role of courtiers to their kings. These serf ballerinas were even trained to attend balls and ceremonial functions, ornaments on the arms of their masters. The line between art and sex was predictably thin, and serf ballerinas, many of whom were highly trained and sensitive artists, often also doubled as concubines or staffed private harems, displaying themselves or performing in the nude or scantily clad, whips as occasional props. Humiliation and self-erasure were among the requisite skills of any dancer. By the mid-19th century, the fiscal structures supporting this feudal indulgence had collapsed, and many of these dancing serfs were subsequently sold to the imperial theaters. There, they won their freedom, but at the cost of a new kind of service, this time to the czar himself. The imperial court decided their professions, this one for theater, that one for dance, and they typically owed a decade of service in exchange for their training. Nor were they free to leave the city or to marry without permission, and sexual exploitation remained commonplace. Years before Georgi arrived at the theater school, serfdom and these residual practices had formally ended. But many of the students and staff at the theater school were still from low or former serf backgrounds, and the imperial theaters were still run, in part, by high-ranking former serf owners and their descendants. The ballet's leading dancer at the time, Matilda Szczesinskaya, Golden Matilda, as she was popularly known, was only the most recent and notorious example of the continuities. The lowly daughter of a Polish character dancer, she had been lavishly kept by the heir apparent, Nicholas himself, with a mansion, jewels, objets d'art, and vacations on the Riviera. When he married and became czar, she moved on to a grand duke. All of this was silently present within the thick stone walls of the Imperial Theater School, which had its own part in the story, too. Its origins stretched back to the early years of the court, when Empress Anna invited a French ballet master to teach the sons and daughters of her palace servants, whose etiquette and comportment were essential to their role at court. At the same time, Anna asked the ballet master to teach the young boys at the Imperial Cadet Corps, the very same elite military training school to which Georgi had just been refused entry. It was another practice related to ballet. From its earliest French and Italian beginnings, ballet had grown up side by side with the military arts. And this pairing also became a central feature of life at the imperial court. And so, when the Tsar's architects designed Rossi Street in the early 19th century and worked to map the court onto the city in stone, they positioned the Imperial Theater School directly across the street from the Vorontsov Palace, home to the Tsar's elite military academy. The military and the dance, the arts of war and peace, close historical cousins with shared steps and methods of training, facing each other in mutual dedication to discipline, rank, and the spectacle of autocracy. This was Georgi's new home. He had arrived at a difficult moment. The court that had given ballet its life was in crisis, and the Tsar and his men were busy building ever thicker walls around the court to block out the mounting signs of imperial collapse. Strikes, assassinations, bombings, famine, and peasant uprisings were all met from the Winter Palace with the full force of repressive state violence. And Nicholas II seemed increasingly ill-equipped for the role history and his own cumulative ineptitude were thrusting upon him. In spite of formal appearances at the lavish celebrations of 300 years of Romanov rule, including a spectacular ballet performance, it was difficult not to find the Tsar increasingly cut off from the people he purported so passionately to represent. He was retreating. Into the inner sanctum of his wife's Victorian domesticity, with its overstuffed furniture, green wreaths, pink ribbons, lilac blossoms, quaint English chintzes and walls hung with glittering icons. Into Fyodorov Village, a toy-like Russian town he built near the Alexander Palace in Tsarskoye Selo, his preferred family residence, where he could attend a specially designed neo-nationalist cathedral and a private cave church dug below. The village was a perfect theatrical fantasy of past grandeur, manned by soldiers reassuringly dressed in 17th-century-style costumes. Even the train station was a stage set, with Muscovite tent roofs reminiscent of early Russian palaces. Not least, Nicholas and the court were retreating into the imperial theaters and the ballet, which seemed to many to represent, as one old aide-de-camp put it to the bewildered French ambassador on the eve of Russia's collapse, a very close picture of what Russian society was and ought to be: order, punctiliousness, symmetry, work well done everywhere. As he retreated, Nicholas was also inadvertently undercutting his own divine aura, in the name of the same misguided nationalism and his people. You could see it in small things. For the first time ever, the Tsar's face was reproduced on postal stamps, circulated and routinely canceled across the realm. To the discomfort of his censors, he even allowed his image to appear on kitschy souvenirs, such as trays, china, candy boxes, and scarves. The line was firmly drawn at handkerchiefs. And in a strange mirror of the traditions of the serf ballerina, Nicholas permitted mere actors to play His Royal Highness on the stage, representing his full majesty in their own lowly image. As Georgi stood on that warm August day in 1913, freshly shorn and uniformed and anxiously awaiting instruction on how to begin his new life, none of them knew just how little time was left. Only a year later, the Tsar would stand stoically on the balcony of the Winter Palace, facing a sea of his people on their knees holding icons and religious banners to announce that Russia was at war. Only 4 years later, Lenin would stand on another balcony, this time at the palatial home of the ballerina Kshesinskaya, before an angry crowd to proclaim the revolution. Lenin would take the notorious and by then sacked residence of Golden Matilda as his headquarters, a symbolic strike at the heart of the court and the world into which little Georgi Balanchivadze now belonged. Inside the school, nothing ever seemed to change or move. Georgi wore the same uniform daily for years, even after the war began to take its depressing toll. Neatly creased military-style black pants, trim white shirt, light blue jacket with the lyre emblem on the collar, and a round, hard-rimmed cadet-style cap. The kind of uniform designed to make a boy stand tall and move with precision. That was for everyday life. For dancing, the boys stripped to a more minimal and revealing, knees visible, costume of shorts with an anonymous plain-fitted shirt, socks, and white ballet shoes, tools of the trade. The girls, who lived separately on the first floor, wore long cornflower blue dresses, demure white pelerines, and black aprons, with pressed white aprons saved for Sundays. Day students wore a motley brown. Younger girls had one braid down their backs and called their elders goddesses. Older girls were allowed two braids and further marked their stature by folding their shawls in large triangles thrown nonchalantly over their backs. For dancing, girls were given modest gray knee-length frocks with petticoats in the lower divisions, pink for the higher, and the coveted pure white frocks for the few girls who reached the top of their class. Purer and purer, a hierarchy of virtue. They all wore clean pink cotton stockings held up at the hips with an elastic band, hair tied neatly back in a low bun, and ballet shoes with ribbons wound twice or thrice around the ankle and tucked neatly in the style of Grecian sandals. The regulations for courtiers were at least as strict and detailed as they were for young dancers. Everyone wore uniforms at court, or at least dressed meticulously according to rank. Patterns of embroidery, length of dress and train, cut, fabric, color were all rigorously prescribed. A change in rank mandated a change in uniform, and like the children of Theater Street who emulated them, courtiers advanced by color, in their case from white to black trousers, red to blue ribbons, silver to gold thread. Nicholas II even decreed separate military and ball uniforms for men, weapons tastefully removed for dancing. And it was not just dress. Gesture, language, seating, place in the hierarchy of official occasions were all carefully mapped and choreographed. Georgi's day began with a call to order. A schoolminder marched through the dorm rooms at the crack of dawn, ringing a loud bell. Then came a cold water wash in a large brass communal sink, then dressing, followed by a second bell signaling inspection. Two straight lines, heads up, arms down, slight bow of the head, curtsy for the girls, and good morning. Then prayers. Breakfast was tea and bread with an egg at 8 a.m. Butter rations could be cut in half and exchanged for pastries twice weekly, followed by lessons at 9 a.m. and ballet class from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Lunch consisted of meat, pasta, and vegetables, after which they all took a walk in the gardens or around the block, strictly supervised by adult minders, with special care taken over the older girls, lest they be spied upon by interested gentlemen. Academic classes were held in small classrooms with slanted wooden desks and chalkboards. And Georgi learned French to address the Tsar, history, geography, arithmetic, Russian language and literature, aesthetics, theatrical makeup, geometry, and catechism, his best subject. The education was serious and had been upgraded after the turn of the century to match Realschule, modeled on the German example. Dinner with dessert was at 4:30 p.m. sharp in the boys' dining hall at long tables with white tablecloths and a school official seated at the head of each. Younger children were formally corrected on etiquette by their elders in an intimidating and ritualized pecking order. And watching over them all was the inevitable icon, this one with a bold red candle behind glass, lodged in the high corner near the ceiling where icons always sit. As if the day would never end, they then took a second dance class, pantomime, fencing, and for the older boys, ballroom dance. A rare chance to meet the girls. Finally, they practiced music, piano for Georgi, and did homework, supped modestly on plain brown kasha, and went to bed exhausted at 9 p.m. Georgi somehow found a little light to read his favorite Max and Moritz, Jules Verne, or Sherlock Holmes stories into the night. Steam baths in the bathhouse happened once a week, or to scrub a child clean upon return from a trip to the filthy city outside. It was a highly regulated life. No sports, ice skating, biking, or playing ball at risk of damaging valuable limbs. Visitors admitted only at set times in a single room under observation. Trips home carefully planned and monitored. When the boys did play, it was Robin Hood or war, but no swords or sabers were allowed. There was actually little need to venture outside the stone box of their compound, since everything the children required was on site, including an infirmary and a small but elegant chapel with a beautifully ornate and bejeweled iconostasis, located at the top of the building, down the hall on the right. The priest was the fastidious but kindly Vasily Faustovich Pigulevsky, who lived in the school with his wife and nine children and loved cards and wine as much as he did God. He had been there since the 1880s and had designed the catechism courses, which included Old and New Testament, Slavic paganism, and Western religions. He took confession, Little fool or idiot, he would chide the students as they enumerated their sins. When Georgi's turn came to serve the communion wine at Lent, he whispered to a new student who looked especially pale and wan, "You can drink it. It tastes good. Don't worry, I'll pour some more." True to their surf ballerina past, the students were a motley collection of orphans, children of former serfs, and children of dancers, ushers, costume ladies, seamstresses, and composers. Many had no father that anyone could speak of, and a few came from military families, or, rarely, the more privileged classes. They were all under the care of strict imperial minders, men and women such as the inspectress Varvara Ivanova Lihosherstova, who, by the time Georgi arrived, had been at the school for as long as anyone could remember. A relic of the impoverished nobility and the daughter of a major general, she was formerly of the august Smolny convent and had her own sad life. Unbeknownst to the children, she had married an officer who died, leaving her alone with two sons and in need of an income. Rigid and difficult and known for her mean temper, she looked a bit like a priest herself with her black robes hung to the floor, mannish square jaw, high white collar fastened with a brooch and shocks of severe white hair. She carried a lorgnette, the better to examine every aspect of her young students' lives. For anyone who broke the rules, as the children all did, the punishments were clear. Time standing alone under the large clock in the corridor, where the other children passed by and meanly pointed or whispered, or no sweets, or no visits home on Saturday, or, worst of all, Sunday grounding. Georgi received his share of these reprimands, dutifully logged in the record book for childhood sins such as yelling, hitting, lying, or making excuses to avoid chores and duties. On many weekends, he escaped this regimented life and went to his aunt's apartment nearby, and sometimes he made the trip home by train to Lunajoki. At Christmas his first year, his father even hosted a party for all the boys, which meant that one weekend a group of staff, teachers, and students bundled onto the train with Georgi and made their way to the Finnish countryside for the day's festivities. It was the kind of party Meliton loved, but that Georgi spent in a corner, shyly watching. But often Georgi stayed at school and spent the empty Sunday afternoons alone in the music room. A large dance studio hung with heavy gilt-framed portraits of the czar and other dignitaries. He didn't seem to mind that the room was haunted by an old monk or singing teacher called Rush or Ricci, who was said to have hanged himself there, to the squeamish delight of children who made a game of seeking out his spirit. In the corner near the ballet bars sat a beautiful and ornate grand piano, sometimes two, and Georgi could stay practicing and improvising for hours in the melancholy company of himself, the czar, and the monkish ghost. Or, in another studio, he could gaze upon the portrait of the darkly mysterious Istomina, a soulful dancer Pushkin had loved and courted and written about nearly a century before. Pushkin's fellow writer Alexander Griboyedov also knew and admired Istomina, who became the cause of a double duel that took the life of an admirer and cost Griboyedov his left hand. Pushkin later planned to write about these dramatic events, but before he could do so, he was himself tragically killed in another duel. In the close atmosphere of the school, all of this could seem very near, especially to a boy who could recite both Pushkin and Griboyedov by heart. Better still, Georgi could peer through the small keyhole in the door to the dance studio where the artists of the Mariinsky Theater rehearsed. It was a secret view, like coming up through the trap door of the old deserted theater in Lunajoki, or being hidden behind the lens of a camera. He saw but couldn't be seen as he peered at the dancers while they worked, spying on the beautiful young women in practice clothes and toe shoes, hair pinned back with wool warmers on their slim legs, and maybe a tutu or skirt and a colorful shawl or thin sweater. The other students called him Rat because he was small, the youngest in the boys' hall, but also because he developed around this time his characteristic sniffing tic, like a rat seeking or busily foraging for shiny tokens in the trash. It was a tic that would endure for most of his life, the first of many masks he would hide behind, and a sign of his nerves and appetite for traveling unnoticed through the worlds he found himself in, collecting scraps and gems to be stored in his mind and later extracted for use in art. Still, even the thick walls and timeless routines of the school and the court could not keep the outside world fully at bay. In the months after the war began in 1914, there was suddenly less sugar. The children went without once a week, a small sign of the terrible sacrifice the war was already exacting on the soldiers and the people outside. Soon, the authorities asked to use the school infirmary to care for wounded men, but court officials politely refused. Instead, there were bandages, all types, in need of sorting for easier use when they reached the injured or maimed, and the children were put to work on the larger piles in their spare time. The landscape outside began to change, too. On their brief excursions and carriage rides to the theater, they glimpsed the Tsar's army recruits, hundreds upon hundreds of them in full military dress, engaged in drills and exercises in the palatial squares nearby. Soon, refugees, the wounded, street children, and orphans of the war arrived as the dispossessed reached the city on trains, on foot, and in makeshift carts and carriages. Dead bodies began to appear too, dull, unannounced facts piled in the streets or on pyres or laboriously removed to the city's overburdened morgues. Trips home became less frequent. Georgi's family was naturally preoccupied. Soon after the war began, Maria's passport tells us she was living at least partly in Petrograd, as St. Petersburg was now called, at various addresses, and an attached photo shows her peering tensely into the camera, her crinoline and lace replaced by a simple workman-like dark wool coat with an unadorned and battered flat-brimmed hat, lips stoically pursed, looking childlike and vulnerable in spite of her 43 years. Another portrait from the time shows her working with the wounded, and we can see her stiffly posed in civilian dress with a group of Red Cross nurses and uniformed soldiers, wrapped for warmth in long gray coats and wearing caps emblazoned with the Tsar's insignia. The rest of the family had dispersed. Tamara was finally admitted to and spent a year at the theater school in 1914, but was not talented enough to be invited back, and she was sent instead to Meliton's brother Ivan's family in a far-off town, and then to Kazimov, where Ivan was deployed. Andrei ended up in Petrograd for school, too, and he and Georgi were together for a while with Aunt Nadia. Meliton was shuttling between them all, working to keep the ever-troubled family interests intact. At the theater, the timeless regimes of artistic life were disrupted, and the adults were naturally tense and preoccupied. Even the glamorous and seemingly untouchable Kshesinskaya was soon presiding over a 20-bed hospital for the wounded in her mansion and making capricious trips to the front with grand dukes she knew. Olga Preobrashenskaya, another prominent but more down-to-earth ballerina, organized performances for the troops and nursed the wounded with her own hands in a makeshift hospital in the courtyard of her home. Other dancers took nurses' training and disappeared to join the war effort. As for the children, life at the school carried on. In spite of these intrusions from the war and the world outside, they were still students, and they still studied and took dance classes. They still went to the theater and danced child roles, even though the whole atmosphere was changed. Now, French, English, Belgian, and Russian anthems played before every performance, and there were benefit nights to raise money for war orphans and the destitute. But the house was still full, if anything, oversubscribed, as audiences took comfort in the habits and luxuries of an increasingly threatened past. Ballet classes began daily at 10 a.m. sharp. Class trained the mind and body, and it was Georgi's formation, the first and most important formal schooling he ever had. And if the bloodline of Russian ballet originated in part with serfdom, its tradition passed through children. Fragile, unformed bodies with still malleable muscles and bones could be purposefully pressed and honed against nature to become symmetrical and aligned, balanced and poised, a body made graceful. The routines of class were so engrossing that the students hardly noticed the increasingly unbearable irony of striving for grace as war crippled and maimed the men fighting outside. This was not a practice of the mind, after all, nor was it a tradition of inquiry. It was more like a religion or a language inculcated through physical habits introduced at a young age that last a lifetime. Knowing what the rituals and movements mean at the moment of mastery is unimportant. That comes later, if it comes at all. So there he was every morning, with the other boys in neat shorts and shoes lined up at the bar, single file, moving in unison to music from a piano sitting in the far corner of the studio. The steps followed a prescribed, centuries-old order. First position, heels together, toes open, hand on the bar to steady the unbalanced body, arms down, back straight up through the spine, shoulders relaxed and wide, belly button pulled to the vertebrae, bones aligned. Release the excess, muscles wrapped around flesh. Simplify, simplify, simplify. It is basic. Find the axis. Drop a plumb line from the top of the head down through the spine into the heels in first position. Divide the body down this center, right from left. Turn out the legs, turn out the feet, turn out the hips, turn out the spine. Open them up. Pry them open. Mostly in life, we stay closed and protected. Practice alignment, precise angles, directions, front, side, back, 30 degrees, 45, 90 degrees. Do it again, again, again. Back to first, back to home. Find the axis. Find the center. Add more, move more, legs higher, arms circling, legs traveling front, side, back, in increasingly complicated patterns and rhythms to the beat in time. All together, stay together, keep the time, push, move, travel, don't think, do, imitate, obey, repeat again, 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 until the body does it alone and the mind is still. Do it without the words, no words. The teacher keeps the words, just imitate. Don't think, don't ask why. Balanchine later said it, dancers are like animals. When dogs bark, they understand each other. We spent a year, I think, he later recalled, learning how the foot touches the floor. When landing from a jump, just that. The foot coming down and making the first point of contact with the floor. It is like a bird landing. We have a Russian word for it, and we grew up with that. And with pain, because even young bodies break. Consider what it means to land from that jump, the full weight of the body coming down to the floor through a single pointed foot. The substantial vertical and centrifugal force of the leap passing through the small metatarsal bones and into a thin ankle, reverberating up to the calf, knee, thigh, hip, spine as the energy exits out through the limbs or the top of the head. Repeat, repeat, repeat. A year of repetition of this one small movement, at least. 8 to 10 years of strenuous training, at least. The ankle, ligaments, or bones can give way in a split second or over the duration, but give they do, and studiously ignoring hurt and aching limbs is part of the training too. People call it discipline, but really it is renunciation of pain, but above all, of physical frailty. Dancers learn to treat their bodies as not quite their own. Just keep going. Hierarchy is the organizing principle of the whole enterprise. The advance from one level to the next through strict mastery of physical feats is the obvious exterior criteria. Ballet is measurable, like math. Either you can do the required steps in the required way and move on, or you can't. But there were other, more hidden hierarchies too, stacked like Russian dolls for young dancers to discover. The Apollonian body was the highest, an ideal of classical proportion and the measure of man, dressed up with the noble etiquette and gestures of the Europeanized aristocracy. Other kinds of bodies were considered less elevated but equally necessary, from the middling medium height and build, that was Georgi, to the short and thick peasant stock. Steps and combinations were similarly ranked. Highest were the controlled adagio dances, slowly showing off the admired noble gestures and proportions, like Greek statuary in motion. Lowest were the quick-paced, bumptious jumps and comic capers of the heavily muscular common folk. Although by Georgi's time, high jumps and turns had been absorbed into the vocabulary of the vaunted danseur noble, thanks to the slow erosion of noble ideals ever since the French Revolution. Like the serf ballerinas before them, the dancers learned to span the social spectrum and play peasants, villagers, townsfolk, courtiers, commanders, princesses, czarinas, and czars. However, there was a chink in the armor of this rarefied court art. Standing at the bar in the studio every morning, the children were all equal before the steps. With effort and practice, any child, any body type, could master the movements. In class, the boys in this case all wore the same anonymous shorts and shoes, practiced the same steps, received the same instruction, and could be forgiven for feeling at moments that they were part of a strictly meritocratic system. Autocratic, but meritocratic. In this simple fact lay the radical secret at the heart of the historically hierarchical forms Georgi was inheriting. Remove the idea of the body as an expression of the social and political order, and you are left with the body as a blank slate. Or, taken further, the body as machine. The bows, gestures, and etiquette of aristocratic life, after all, were vestiges. Vestiges of the French nobility, vestiges of serfdom, vestiges of a European past. The tension, the problem, lay in the thin line between free will, possible but not encouraged, and the rote movements of the automaton. The solutions for that would come later. For now, boys like Georgi, aged 9 or 10 or 11, faced simpler questions. Can you hit the ceiling with your hand at the height of a jump? Can you turn 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 times? How much can you do physically? Just how fast and far can you move, and what does it take to break free? Georgi was learning steps, but he was also learning how to learn. Dancers do not work from texts because there are no texts. Dances are passed from person to person, from one dancer's body to another. Nothing is written down, and little or less is said. Children learn instead through imitation, monkey see, monkey do, except not quite. Dancing is more than mere copying, and requires a talent and physical intelligence evident in a young dancer from the start. It involves an instinctive eye-body coordination that some people just have, while others are blocked at the barrier of the mind. They see but cannot translate what they see onto their own bodies. Nothing happens physically, or something happens, but it is flat and uninteresting, too literal. Imitation is like the talent of the jester, the mime, the clown whose animation illuminates the play, or the translator animating a foreign text. It takes erasing. erasing the ego but not the hand, the touch, the body, the thing that animates. Balanchine had this physical instinct in abundance. He was never a refined dancer, but he was a wicked mimic. He later mercilessly aped Trotsky and could immediately catch the essence of any person, step, or gesture in his own body. Learning to instantly reproduce and recall long, intricate sequences of movement and gesture is something more mysterious. It has to do with music and memory. Dancers' bodies are like the memory palaces of antiquity. The idea of the memory palace, after all, was always physical. As ancient sources tell us, there was once a banquet at which the ceiling collapsed and the guests at the table were instantly killed, and their bodies mangled beyond recognition. A poet, however, had stepped out of the room just in time and survived. At first, he was unable to identify the bodies or to recall who exactly had been at the dinner, but finally he was able to name each guest by going around the table in his mind and recalling where each had been seated. Memory depended on physical location, on the seating chart in the poet's mind. From there came the idea of a palace with many rooms and many tables, with closets and drawings to put things in. For dancers, music is that kind of palace. Every piece of music has a structure, and dancers become intimately acquainted with its rooms and corridors. They know where to find the steps and gestures because they are ordered by the music, located in space and time. Once a dancer physically enters the music, which is different from dancing externally to or with the music, and internalizes the rhythm, the basic pulse or beat, the steps take on that necessary order and sequence. Great dancers can match their own inner pulse, their very own heart rate, to the musical pulse, which is a way of taking the music inside the body, eating the music, eating the steps. At that moment, the steps become fixed to the music in the body of the dancer. The dancer knows them both by heart. Begin at the beginning. You don't remember? Go back, run it again, take it from the top. If you start from the beginning, the rest will follow, like the seating chart at the table or the rooms in the palace. But trained dancers do more. They don't have to start at the beginning or at the head of the table to recall the sequence. They can enter midstream, get into the palace through any door. Drop the needle in the middle of a piece of music, and a trained dancer will know where she is. She can enter time at any point in a sequence. In this sense, dance training is not about rote memorization at all. It is about time, the passage of time and moving around in time precisely. The memory of a dance can last longer and run deeper than the memory of poetry or an actor's lines, perhaps because, akin to physical trauma, the body was there. If years later a dancer hears the music for a dance she once knew, really physically knew, her legs and arms will automatically start to do the steps, even if she has long since forgotten them. It is Proust's Madeleine for the body. Suddenly, you are there. Ballet keeps children children. It works against growing up and aging, halts the process by suspending the mind. Don't think, just do. Balanchine's later mantra, implicit in his early training, is a way of prolonging youth. Physically, of course, dancing keeps the body young by honing its natural beauty, and dancers often look young long after they are. This is because they were once so fit, perhaps, but also because ballet begins with androgyny. The childish body is androgynous, angelic even, and ballet preserves that lithe, nymph-like flexibility, especially in girls, whose bodies are more malleable and naturally slight. Men and women will later train differently to their strengths, but that childishness never quite disappears, and dancers naturally return to a moment of seemingly limitless physical capacity. Ask any old dancer trained from childhood to perform a ballet, and in the split second of her movement, you will see in her aged body the astonishing return of her youth. Teachers rely on this uncanny experience. In the 70-year-old former ballerina, you can immediately detect and imitate the 17-year-old girl. Gyorgy's main teacher was Samuel Adrianov, a tall, slim, elegant dancer who was still young, barely 30, and actively performing. He taught in his street clothes, and his dapper but modest image and devotion to his students left a deep impression. He was married to one of Gyorgy's favorite ballerinas and teachers, Elisaveta Gert. Gert was pure, clean, cool, although some critics, Balanchine later explained, called her a vegetarian dancer and saw her as icy, without blood. They wanted a hot dancer, he said, but he thought she was wonderful, like crystal. Her father, Pavel Gert, a tall dancer with an elegant physique from an old Russianized German family, had taught her. And so it went. Dancer begat dancer, in a long chain reaching back in living memory deep into the 19th century. Pavel Gert had worked directly with Marius Petipa and Pyotr Tchaikovsky. On Sundays and Wednesdays, ballet nights at the theater even during the war, a horse-drawn carriage would arrive at the school entrance to fetch the children, Gyorgy among them, to perform child roles in the evening's ballets. They called it Noah's Ark. And in the winter, it was a sleigh with uniformed footmen, and they went wrapped in furs. The carriage transported the children through the narrow streets and up over the cobblestones of the wide-open plaza in front of the theater, past the trolley, past the lampposts, past the ticket queues of students and workers who couldn't afford subscriptions that wound around the palatial Marinsky Theater. Now past the soldiers and the wounded, too, and the ragged, homeless children about their age in thin-soled shoes. The theater had been named by Tsar Alexander II after his German wife, Empress Marie, although when the war came, its name became Petrograd, like the city itself, a reminder that Germany was now an enemy force. The theater's flat dome and elegant portico entrance, and its seemingly endless proliferating quarters added over the years to the main building in the style of the nearby Winter Palace, made the building look grand and imposing, a spectacle unto itself. The students climbed from the carriage and slipped into the side entrance, reserved for orchestra members and children of the school, and mounted the 6 flights up to their dressing rooms. Remember that theaters do not have windows. They are closed off, worlds apart with their own sources of light and darkness, more closed even than the stone school. This one was a sprawling territory of sewing rooms and costume workshops with massive stone pillars and long serviceable wooden tables strewn with silk, gold, tulle, bright ribbons. Whole wings were devoted to costume painting. And there were prop shops and several enormous hangar-like workshops for developing sets and decor. There were also large and small dressing rooms, women to one side of the stage, men to the other, photography studios, a dedicated shoe room, and vast spaces where costumes were stored, not to mention dance studios and music practice rooms, along with manifold offices full of people noisily attending to the business of art. In the front of the house, the main cloakroom had efficient school-like cubbies and tables for packages and umbrellas and orderly rows of hanging space. There were elegant enclaves for royal dinners and events, chandeliered and tucked off the main halls with small tables laid with fine linen and china. A large open foyer with cold floors and high ceilings welcomed the public. The green room was located in the no man's land between the public and the backstage. During intermissions, the imperial family and other dignitaries, dressed in full regalia, could go there to smoke and enjoy the company of costumed ballerinas stretching their limbs and warming up for their parts. The inner sanctum of the theater itself was soft and feminine, a boudoir almost, powder blue, gold, curved and ornamented, with plush chairs for spectators. On ballet nights, the house was packed with members of the court in full evening dress, although during the war a more sober look eventually took hold. High officials, military men, and imperial guards traditionally occupied the front orchestra, and in the diamond row one could find officers with spurs and remarkable mustaches, ladies with bare snow-white bosoms, diamonds, perfume, lace. The front row of the stalls was reserved for ballademains, a strange breed of male spectator, later despised by Balanchine, obsessively in love with this dancer or that. Gossips, fans who were temperamentally, the theater's director sourly noted, monarchists, adherents of olden times, of fictitious traditions, essentially of routines. Once upon a time, they cooked, carved, and ate the old ballet shoes of the legendary dancer Marie Taglioni. The gallery, upper tiers, and loges were packed with a full array of Russian society. Students, women and families, clerks, lackeys, servants, valets, and artisans. Everyone came. The Tsar had his own large and impressively lavish box facing the stage, framed by its own proscenium arch. To Balanchine as a child, it seemed like a colossal apartment with blue walls. Although Nicholas II sometimes chose instead to sit in the corner box next to the stage, where he could look out over the entire house of his people. Various other Romanovs occupied the boxes in the tier above. The ushers wore tailcoats with the Tsar's double-headed eagles, and the deep royal blue stage curtain was emblazoned with the same eagles, signaling his power and domination over his assembled realm. Above the proscenium, a large ornate clock, lovingly supported by two golden cupids, marked the time as the orchestra played below. On special days, the children of the theater school might be escorted ceremonially to the Tsar, where they were introduced one by one. "This is Balanchivadze," as they each bent to kiss the hand of Nicholas II. The great Tsar, who was in fact small, of slight build, effeminate, would then bestow upon each appropriately awestruck child a large gold box of fancy chocolates bearing the imperial insignia. Balanchine later recalled the thrill. "Like army meets general, you know. They stand waiting and general comes in, and it was like that." Discipline was paramount. And indeed, the leading positions in court ministries were often recruited from high military echelons. The director of all Russia's imperial theaters at the time was one Vladimir Arkadyevich Telyakovsky, officer of the Horse Guards, Academy of the General Staff, with the rank of colonel. He ran 10 theater buildings, 7 troops, 7 string orchestras, 2 brass bands, 2 choruses, 2 theater schools, a library, a photography department, 2 medical facilities, a carriage department, 4 electricity generating stations, a publications department, and other technical support departments. It was a sprawling administrative empire on an openly autocratic model that Balanchine would later emulate. Authority ran to Telyakovsky and directly to the Tsar himself. Georgi learned the theater's every aspect as he hurried through its long corridors on performance days. He grew accustomed to life backstage, with dancers and ballerinas milling about, half-dressed, made up, gossiping, adjusting bodices, tights, tulle, ribbons, silk, jewelry, costumes, shoes, all crowded into the half-lit wings awaiting a cue. Stagehands were there pulling sets and attending to lights. Conductors and musicians who weren't yet in the pit loitered among the stage managers, costumers, prop men, and hairdressers. The air was thick with the smells of makeup, fabric, sweat, paint, light, oils, resin, perfume. Like dancers everywhere, Georgi pulled up his tights and put on his shoes, tight slippers with elastics to secure the arch, and dipped his feet into the box of sticky amber rosin crystals, crunched to smithereens by imposing ballerinas and hard toe shoes. Someone sprinkled the slippery and sharply raked wooden stage with water from gray tin cans, like watering a garden for still better grip. One bell for half hour, two bells for 15 minutes, and three bells calling the dancers immediately to the stage. Electric lights, still relatively novel, could be blinding, and there were plentiful enchanting stage effects, too, engineered with real fire, water, and animals. On stage, Georgi witnessed fountains running colored water, burning buildings, lilac bushes that magically grew, live horses and rotating floors that seemed to carry the dancers across space and time. Monkey, a student, the program noted. That was me, Balanchine, proud of the anonymity, later told a friend. He was a monkey in the lavish court spectacle Le Talisman, with the perfumed and bejeweled Golden Matilda in the lead role. He performed child roles across the imperial repertory, mostly in ballets of Marius Petipa, a small Saracen in Raymonda, where he climbed over the parapet to see a crusader killing a man whose head ran with blood, a toy soldier in The Fairy Doll, a Spanish boy in Don Quixote, a child in the garden dance in The Sleeping Beauty, an Egyptian in Daughter of Pharaoh, a soldier, a mouse, and eventually the athletic leaping candy cane in The Nutcracker. He danced a mazurka, too, in bright white tights and military tunics in Paquita, a mirror image of the military parades the children could see on the plazas outside. He watched. Bekefi, a Hungarian dancer, for example, in a sardas or a polonaise, and mazurka the dancers had learned from the Polish dancer Szaszynski. Matilda's father, who enriched himself by instructing aristocratic families to perform their own mazurkas at fancy dress balls. He saw Pierre Vladimirov, the company's rising danseur noble, better than the great Nijinsky, it was whispered, although at the time, Georgi didn't much like the dancers everyone else admired. Danseurs nobles seemed to him stiff and too clean, far from the dashing Turks and Cossacks that filled his boyish imagination. But he was nonetheless taking it all in, and he would later hire Vladimirov to teach in his American school. As Georgi took his place in the wings and scrambled onto the stage, he was playing his role as servant to the Tsar, part of a self-conscious display of the imperial social order paraded across the stage inside the theater, just as outside it was beginning to collapse. He watched the dancers form themselves like soldiers in perfectly straight lines, moving with precision in strictly measured time. He watched the hierarchy and the order. He watched the older dancers playing peasants, villagers, townsfolk, courtiers, commanders, princesses, czarinas, and czars. But looking back, you could see that Georgi had arrived at a moment of disorientation and loss. The theater and the ballet, the walled world within the walled court, were in the midst of their own crisis, too. To begin with, Marius Petipa was dead. Petipa had been the reigning ballet master of the Tsar's imperial ballet for some 50 years, from his arrival from Paris in 1847 until his retirement in 1903, and his ballets still made up the greater part of the company repertory. These were the dances Georgi grew up with, and Petipa was everywhere in his life. The old ballet master had died in 1910, but his rehearsal chair was still sitting empty in one of the main dance studios. The students believed that if you sat on it, you might meet his ghost. One evening, creeping to the spot secretly in the dark, Georgi and a friend tried. Petipa died when I was about 6 years old, Balanchine later remembered. But Tchaikovsky and Petipa were alive for me, and people around me talked about them as if they were alive. In his young mind, they were alive. And over the years, Petipa would even seem at moments to inhabit him. Like Russians becoming European, Georgi was imitating, ingesting, and swallowing whole. And he would eventually freely borrow steps and patterns, but also music from this man he never met. He even took on, or shared, Petipa's practice of watching performances tucked quietly into his first wing post. Tchaikovsky was dead, too. Everyone knew of his passing, and the uncertain causes of his untimely death in 1893, and of his legendary funeral service, organized by the Directorate of the Imperial Theaters with a full orchestra at the Kazan Cathedral, with 60,000 people gathered for 6,000 places. Tchaikovsky and Petipa had changed ballet forever, just as Balanchine would later revolutionize the art with Stravinsky. Tchaikovsky's music was floating everywhere in the dancers' lives, in ballets, in class, in music lessons. And Balanchine never shied from this vast childhood resource. He spoke freely to anyone willing to listen of his conversations with the dead but close Tchaikovsky, and looked to the composer constantly across the mortal divide for advice and guidance as he made his own ballets to the composer's music. "He helped me, or else he would say don't." Meanwhile, Petipa had complained bitterly when he was old and infirm that his ballets without him were fraying. "Not my dances." It was true that the courtly life Petipa's ballets expressed was fading, and that he was no longer there to keep alive his own legacy and the record of the world he and his dancers had celebrated. Without his personal presence, endless squabbles erupted over the details of his languishing steps. Factions formed, and in a premonition of the drama that would follow Balanchine's death, a fight for power over the ballets and their future ensued. But dancers still had to dance, and Petipa's embattled ballets mostly settled into a stolidly classical mold, embalmed for the benefit of future generations. By the time Georgi encountered them, they were even more conservative than they had been in the first place. That was part of the tradition, too. A new and revolutionary generation, meanwhile, came and went, and Georgi and his friends missed it. It all started before he was born, but came to a head in the wake of the upheavals of Bloody Sunday in 1905. Sympathy strikes, meetings, and protests erupted across St. Petersburg, and Rimsky-Korsakov, Meliton's teacher, sided with the strikers and was dismissed from the prestigious Conservatory of Music. Glazunov angrily followed in protest, though both later returned to their duties. When the Tsar issued his concessionary but short-lived October Manifesto, riots erupted at the opera, "Down with Autocracy," and the dancers at the Mariinsky organized their own strike. A group of young dancers led by Mikhail Fokin, Anna Pavlova, and Tamara Korsavina held secret meetings, and the students at the theater school, Vaslav Nijinsky among them, staged protests. They were a new breed. They read and paid attention to politics, and some of them were radicalized. They went to work for the people, and they wanted a greater say in the running of the theater and the future of their art. And although the strike was subsequently peacefully resolved, those who had taken part in the meetings were never quite the same. The long-established bond joining them obediently to the Tsar had been severed. In 1909, many from this new generation abruptly left St. Petersburg to perform in Paris with the young impresario Sergei Diaghilev. By 1911, most had cut their ties to the Imperial Theaters and moved to Europe to dance with his new and renegade Ballet Russe. And although some returned home briefly when World War I erupted, this youthful and radical life force of dance had largely moved abroad, leaving the ballet Georgi entered as a boy bereft of its most innovative energy and spirit. But institutions, like people, can live parallel lives. And word of the glamorous Parisian seasons of these riotous breakaway dancers filtered back through letters, tales, and fragments whispered in classrooms and hallways. The mere fact of their existence set a precedent. The year Georgi arrived at the school, 1913, aged 9, was also the premiere in Paris of Nijinsky and Stravinsky's Sacre du Printemps. Georgi didn't know, but he found out. Meanwhile, Petipa's ghost continued to rule their small lives. Every time the dancers went on stage in one of his many ballets, they encountered the old ballet master's mind. Even in child roles, they entered into the structure of his dances. Like walking through an old, still-furnished house recently deserted by its owner. The composition and construction, the way the steps made the body move, the patterns of people, the narrative frame, all of that was still there, no matter the fraying. Night after night, year after year, Georgi and his friends climbed into the skin of Petipa's art. No wonder Balanchine later insisted that his own dancers learn the same rules, feel the same music, and repeat the dances until they were fully incorporated, a permanent part of the person. Petipa was like an anchor dropped into the body of this small boy. It is easy to feel sick before performing one of Petipa's variations. They are too physically demanding, too mentally intricate, and you know before you start that a moment's lapse can shatter everything and leave even the most skilled dancer stumbling, panting, in fragments. With success, it is like being inside a great idea, full of the energy that comes at the instant of insight. Legs strong, incisive, slicing through the rhythms. Yet the legs that seem to control it all, you can't even see them. These are tutu dances, and that odd pancake costume strung around the waist with a hint of the Baroque cuts the dancer off from her own feet and legs, as if from her own past. A body divided. You can't check, you have to trust, and the rules are strict. The slightest false move or cheat, a leg straying off center or a step out of line, immediately throws the whole body into disarray, like a poem poorly scanned. The patterns across the stage are mirrored in the body, front, back, diagonal. Three repeats almost superstitiously, three steps, three times, three directions, three like beginning, middle, end, three like the Trinity. Three like Pythagoras's theorem. Ballets never say what they are about, but one way to discover their motives is to keep counting. And dancers are constantly counting, marking time. Just go, don't stop, just go, the teacher would say, pushing the dancer from behind. Push a bit ahead, just a hair, so the body doesn't lose track. Equilibrium is forever perilous, and the stage floor at the Marinsky was dangerously raked, slanted at a sharp angle so that audiences could better see the whole. Dancers learned to calibrate their balance and weight on this disorienting incline, like dancing on the deck of a ship, tilting to sink. But Petipa presented a problem, too. In his dances, the only way forward was back into enchanted worlds like the 100-year dream of the Sleeping Beauty, with its princes and fairies and courtly rituals of birth, love, and marriage. Petipa was the cloistered enclave that ballet and the court had become. And by the end of 1916, the world outside and the ravages of the war that Russia was losing were becoming impossible to ignore. Food was increasingly scarce and fuel in dangerously short supply. It was cold. Dancers were performing without heat or proper nutrition, their thinning limbs wrapped in wool and down if they could find it. As they danced, their breath froze in a white mist midair. Outside, inflation was spiraling out of control. Who could find or afford sugar now? The streets were thicker and thicker with dead and crippled bodies, and the stench of decay and disease could be overwhelming. Politically and militarily, the situation was dire. The Czar had lost touch almost completely, and faced with crisis upon crisis, he burrowed deeper and deeper into the sterile and fatalistic dogma of autocracy and his own divine right. That frigid December day, when Georgi was escorted into the Tsar's box at the theater and felt he was meeting a general, anyone watching might have wondered, general of what? The Tsar's armies, largely composed of peasants and the children of serfs who had been freed, were dying in his streets and fields. Georgi, a friend noted around this time, looked thin and pale, almost transparent. He was 12. Chapter 4. A Cloud in Trousers. They started to shoot. People were running, shouting, firing from windows and rooftops. And there were police, soldiers, and bodies falling dead in the wide imperial streets. At barely 14 and still slight of build, Georgi was running too in those early revolutionary days, crouching in doorways and darting down side streets to avoid the gunfire. The Imperial Theater School and the Cadet Corps across the road were natural targets. And one afternoon, a bullet tore through the school window, shattering glass as the children dropped to the floor. Armed men later broke into the building and held one of the schoolminders at gunpoint as they searched the premises for monarchists. But finding only children and dancers, they abruptly departed. Another day, several hundred armed men and frozen soldiers from the 137th Infantry Division took over the premises as a shelter, and ballet classes were suspended until the authorities eventually moved the soldiers along, fearful that the floors wouldn't hold their weight. Nothing felt safe, and even as the children slept in neat rows in their dormitory beds, or later moved to the tighter quarters of the infirmary for warmth, there was always the chance of being awakened by the sound of executions taking place in the streets below. The walls of their lives had finally been breached. As the havoc of the revolution took hold, basic supplies grew scarce. The school struggled to care for the children until finally it couldn't. It closed. Then it reopened to day students only. With thinning faculty and students fleeing to their families, they were a rump group. Enclosures were intermittent. By the fall of 1918, in an unlikely turn of events, the school managed to reopen for good. This time, in the name of the workers and the new socialist state. Meanwhile, Georgi was back and forth between this beleaguered imperial institution and his worried mother and aunt on Bolshaya Moskovskaya, but mainly, like most of the city, he was living in the streets. The streets of the Tsar's once orderly town were occupied by workers, peasants, soldiers, revolutionaries. There were protests, processions, military bands, speeches, funerals, and thousands upon thousands of men in dark coats and caps, and women with scarves wrapped tightly around their heads, gathered carrying banners, red flags, icons, coffins. Disruption became a fact of life, as sabotage, requisitions, and long queues for food vied with intermittent fighting between reds, whites, greens, blacks, anarchists, nationalists. It was a chaos of civil war and terror unfolding in their lives. And in these extreme and unpredictable conditions, shops were boarded up, transport suspended, and street lights out due to cuts in electricity. Even horses, the only power left standing, were gnawing on wood or being shot or sold for a pittance. Who could afford to feed them? As people struggled to survive, the injured and maimed continued to arrive and could be seen sitting listless and uncared for in alleyways and stations. Bands of orphaned or abandoned children joined them, camping in the streets, under boats and bridges, inside barrels or garbage cans, and even among the dead in cemetery vaults, anything to escape the icy winter winds. Soon after Lenin's arrival in Petrograd, Georgi found himself standing in one of these crowds, this time at the ballerina Kshesinskaya's old mansion, which had long since been ransacked and occupied by revolutionaries who lounged dirty from fighting on the settees and grand staircases of her silk and gilt imperial splendor. Lenin was using her home as his headquarters at the time, where, from the balcony one day, he furiously expounded his April theses. "Europe, too, is on the eve of revolution," he shouted down at the restless crowd. And on May Day that year, the children of the school, which reopened for a moment, participated in a mass outdoor demonstration and revolutionary spectacle with an engulfing cast of thousands. Georgi was hungry. His mother sent him to the store where he used to buy bread, he recalled. "And it's enormous, and there's no bread, and they make fun. Oh, there's no bread today. And the next place there's no bread, and the next day there's no bread. Then it is terrifying." His life rolled into one urgent pursuit: get food, somehow. Maybe if person has a pinch of salt or gives you matches, and finally you go around on the street and you try to see if a person has a piece of bread or potato peels. Sometimes people have potato peels, and you say, "I have matches, do you have potato peels?" They say yes, and you give the matches, and they give the potato peels. Or somebody with salt, pinch of salt, and you get coffee grinds, used already, but you eat them. Or someone makes a coffee grind cake. Awful, nothing, no bread, nothing. When I say awful, I know because I didn't eat for days and days. Or sometimes, rarely, the city or the government had food. You find out next week on Friday giving away some bread, and you have to register and some kind of ticket. Then you get into the big line, which you stay, night, day, and the next night, and they give you a piece of bread. Or some days it was soup. Red Cross gives you wonderful stuff. It was warm, dirty water with little thrown in cucumber peels. I don't know where the cucumbers went, but was cucumber peels and potato peels sometimes you find in it. That's what it was, gray water, and you have your own little thing like that, tin cup, and they give you that. It was everyone like that. It was starving, starving. Or you eat cats if you can. But more often, there was no pussycat on the street because people would grab them and eat them. One time, a horse fell dead in its tracks from disease, and he watched as people rushed with knives to cut pieces and carve whatever was left on the starved beast's bones, an image scarred into his brain for life. Sometimes he even went to the black basement of the theater, where boys with quick, terrified fingers could catch rats for eating. He stole things. The army, or something like that, would have a barge with dry fish or something. And near Fontaka River for army, Red Army, we used to go, myself and others, and go and run and grab this fish, sometimes a live fish, and one friend grab a live fish and he is running, with the fish thumping against his chest. Or they would find the small, dry, not a carp, dry, dry, dry fish, he later saw in Jewish delis in New York, salted and piled in great mounds by old women on the streets to be sold. If you were careful, you could snatch a handful and fly away through the streets and gobble the fish to expunge, momentarily, the terrible fear that hunger brings. He worked where he could, anything for food, and later remembered sewing leather saddles and bridles and reins for an old saddler. You work and work, and he has a little money, and he gives you, but money doesn't mean anything. Like $1 million might be 5 cents, or soup or something if he has prepared it, or coffee grinds. Another job meant walking through the dark streets late at night, hovering in doorways for safety to an awful, dreary, small movie house. He played piano there for silent pictures, most dreariest thing, small movie far away in the dark, and I used to walk there, took hours, no streetcars, in the dark, small screen, elongated room, almost like Luna Park, Max Linder, mostly. He stayed for hours, bent over the piano, improvising waltzes, marches, little songs, anything he knew. Sometimes they gave him something in return. But more often they sent him away empty-handed, "Get the hell out of here!" And he made his way back through the cold streets with their gleaming black puddles of melted, dirty snow. As the months went on, he developed painful welts on his skin from malnutrition. At one point, a friend counted 30 of these oozing boils to her 5. Eventually, a cough came too. The first signs of the TB infection that would plague and weaken him for years to come. The stench, as they moved through the city in the warmer months, could be unbearable.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.